First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
No doubt. It's time to get in contact and reconnected to the creator, your higher self. Yeah, tonight is, we got someone very special once again. It's my man, the God, Brother Panic, Master Teacher, and he getting ready to drop a whole lot of info on you. All right, this is the Dr. Ali Mel Bay Show, and I'll be getting ready to pull him on in. Brother Panic, are you there?
Hey, brother, what's going on? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Loud and clear.
All right. Good to be back up in the house.
No
Brother
doubt,
Aleem on the Dr. Aleem Bay Show once again.
Hey, you know, the people are happy.
Know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, we're going to pick up where we left off. If y'all wasn't here last week, y'all need
y'all
to go download last week's show. You know, a lot of information. And we're going to pick that, you know, we're going to keep it going. That's what we're here to do. So we're going to keep it going tonight, you know. So, I just want to make an announcement as well. You know, I've been putting this out, but we need to put this out on the Dr. Aleem show that I've been talking about since late October about doing lectures in Atlanta. So we are there now. We are there, and our first guest speaker will be Dr. Aleem Bay. So I know y'all need to see him live in Gainesville. If you're in the area, or you're in the, you know, in the neighboring states, you need to bring your asses on down. You know what I mean? And this is what you do. There's going to be an official flyer coming soon. But what you need to do is to start to get information about the lecture, because we're doing advanced tickets. Because I went to this location, and it's a big, nice location, but it gets packed really quick. So for, you know, the people who listen to some of my work and the people who listen to Dr. Aleem Bay, we want to be able to do advanced tickets for you guys first, so to make sure you get the spot. So we're going to start doing the tickets next week, but you need to start communicating now. So what you need to do is email me, AtlantaLectures@hotmail.com. Atlanta Lectures with a S at hotmail.com to find out ticket prices. It's going to be for 2 days. It's going to be on March 17th and 18th. That's a Saturday and a Sunday. The Saturday is a libation day. It's more of a meet and greet, dealing with vendors. Dr. Aleem will be in the house. Maybe he'll ask questions and you guys get to meet and greet him face to face. And on Sunday, the very next day, will be the actual lecture. The times, we're not sure the times, but they'll be pretty much standard times. Usually the standard is 2 to 10, so it'll be somewhere around there. But you need to hit me at AtlantaLectures@hotmail.com to start getting information. And, you know, you'll eventually get that flyer and so on and so forth. We're taking PayPal orders. And we're also taking money out the door if you just decide to come late. So as people pack the room, I want people to know Dr. Aleem Bay will be my first lecture. I mean, I know he's going to put that energy on it. If I remember correctly, he was the first lecturer for my boy Shabazz at Eye Opener Productions, which started a legacy of lectures that are still happening to this day. So I want that same energy. So the person I thought of was Dr. Aleem. If y'all never heard him live or never heard him teach live, that's something y'all need to see. It goes to a whole other level than what you can possibly hear just on the radio. Not to cheapen anything that you have heard on the radio, but a live lecture is a whole different animal. So this is something you want to be for the first lecture that we're going to do in the series. So AtlantaLectures@hotmail.com. Well, I just wanted to get all of that out the way before we get into our thing, Dr. Bay.
No doubt. And I'm glad you got a chance to definitely put that out there to them. And, we want support. You know, we need support, you know, so definitely get in contact. Like Brother Panic said, you know, shoot, Atlanta Lectures@hotmail.com, you know, so check
right.
it out and come on down, you know, if you live in South Carolina, North Carolina, Florida,
right.
or Alabama, bring your behinds to the Atlanta area and peep some of this information. Y'all hear us here on the radio, and right now, Panic, I'm telling you. I think you being on here is one of the largest. Now, I've done had other guests on here. I done had Queen of Four on here and others. And right now, you know, I mean, we done
right.
had like, I mean, we done had so many hits. You know, I mean, you already getting ready to surpass my largest show, which dealt with the UFOs and the macabres and alien invasions.
Wow.
You know how niggas love that, you know?
Right, right. Right.
You get ready to surpass that. So, you know, I'm telling you, you know, that this is big, you know. So if y'all want to see us live, you know,
right.
you know, come on and check us out, you know. But
yeah,
we'll
be in the house. Right. We'll be up in the house. It'll be up close and personal. I said the lecture, anything that you're seeing in by way of consciousness, really, you know, to be absolutely honest, is always secondary compared to the live lecture. That's a whole different energy, whole different animal. If you haven't went to any, you know, this is the perfect opportunity to go to some, and you're going to one of the masters in teaching. Like I said, I said it last week, I said it the week before, and I'll say it again. Aleem was one of the first guys that the lecturers that I went to see live and left that impression, one of the first master teachers. So you got, you know, this is absolutely a treat for you. You know what I mean? So, you know, I can't say enough about it. And this really isn't about just door money. This is really about teaching. You get what I'm saying? Really about you getting something out of the little bit of money you're going to spend, you know what I mean, to get in. We're not doing big prices neither. And I might as well tell the prices for the first day, which is the meet and greet, libation, drumming, the networking, we're going to do $25. The lecture night is going to be $30 in advance and probably the same at the door. I don't think we're going to change at the door. We're still formulating. So it's really not that much to really get something big out of it. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, and I know what you're saying. Like, it seems on Blog Talk Radio, I have this legendary following. I just really don't know what it's about, you know. There's this legendary following. People always say, hey, you break records. But see, I don't do too many shows outside of Miss Blue, you know what I mean? But see, you know, me and Aleem have a relationship because there's so many people who ask. So I try to, you know, I try to keep it to stuff that's relevant and so on and so forth. And, you know, none of it goes to my head, you know what I mean? it is what it is. People are just ready to hear, and we just ready to dispense. And it's always good, you know, when you with good people to do it. And, you know, I don't think there's too much more to say besides getting to the science, I guess.
No doubt, no
doubt.
While
they pack the room. Okay, yeah, so
right,
what
right.
we were talking about, yeah, all right, what we were talking about last week was basically the Holy Grail, the pineal gland, and breaking down some of the mythology around it. A lot of that mythology is from Arthurian, what they call it Arthurian lore, but it's the Arthur, King Arthur and the Holy Grail. And you need to hear last week's show, I'm not going to recap, but we were locking them into Osiris and all the other mythologies that you know. So we're going to keep on with that. And this is something I want to read, continuing on this, breaking down more of this mythology. All right. Heads of horses were also believed to contain the all-important vital force as well as the ever-present and necessary element of fertility. It is said that the Merovingian kings were sometimes buried with a horse's head, for example, the king, King Chitrich. Now, the horse is a symbol of the astral world as well. If you see, well, you got Pegasus, for one. Medusa turns into Pegasus. Pegasus represents the rising Christ. Jesus also comes back on a horse. So the Christ energy on the horse represents the vehicle. It represents Kundalini. The unicorn also with the horn representing the pineal. So the before there was a car or anything for traveling, they used horses. So a horse in mythology always represents the astral, how you get from place A to place B. Now, this
but
is,
even
this
in
is,
the, even in the with cars, I mean they call it horsepower.
Mm-hmm.
You know when they rev
right,
up the
horsepower.
Engine.
Right, right,
so,
right,
I mean,
right. It's still right. It still right. was based upon the horse. Uh huh. Yes, excellent. Now, mm-hmm. Now, the like buried with the horse's head. That's you know just that's a symbolic of the king being able to travel through the astral world or through the underworld. Now, horses' heads were also carried on ritualistic occasions. The pagan hobby horse, for instance, was a real shamanistic accoutrement. Symbolizes the shaman's trusty steed, which carries with him to the underworld. In the myth associated with the Norse god Odin, the horse actually carries Odin into the underworld. Many myths, the shamanistic deity said to return on a horse. That's again Jesus coming back on a horse. You know, just behold the pale horse thing. Blah 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 blah.
Right. And even then, nope. we even look at the hadith surrounding Prophet Muhammad on the night of the Miraj, you know, where he was taken up into the seven heavens on a horse-like winged creature, you know.
Uh-huh.
So that mythology is told over and over again. And then, of course, as he was taken up, he went through the seven heavens and until he was able to see God face-to-face or Allah face-to-face.
Uh-huh.
Goes
uh-huh.
back to Jacob.
Uh-huh.
You know, in that whole story with the pineal gland, you know.
Right, right.
32nd chapter there, so no doubt.
Interesting. So now we know, okay, so this horse symbolizes astral traveling or astral power, Kundalini as well. It also is resurrection from Medusa. See, Medusa represented raw Kundalini energy. But in its base, and
right.
And it's also symbolized as the black woman. So her turning into Pegasus and freeing herself, or even them taking her head, which represented that Kundalini power, and being able to show it, and people would turn to stone, meaning they were absorbing her Kundalini energy, or absorbing Kundalini energy to whoever looked at her head, because she represented the resting Kundalini or Kundalini in the polarity of when it's locked down. So her expanding, of course, is this horse for travel and wings for flight as Pegasus. So Medusa was stealing the Kundalini because it represented the Kundalini at the base, the resting. Or just look at it as the polarity was different from expanding. Now, let me see, known today as the Astral Body, which enabled to travel internally to other worlds. Today, we could possibly use the modern automobile for this symbol. Like the white horses of our ancestors, no doubt. Symbolic device scrawled up on the landscape, each tribe having their own particular style of horse. Now, when you think of the horse more as a vehicle as well, and when you apply it to the Holy Grail mysteries, this is what I started to talk about last week, that most people say, well, it's the Holy Grail and the Philosopher's Stone. Now, we've already got that. The Holy Grail represents the head itself. And most people say, well, the Philosopher's Stone is obviously the pineal. But there's also mythology that the thalamus gland in the middle of the brain, which is egg-shaped, is actually the Philosopher's Stone. And the pineal gland can also be looked at as the vehicle or the quest to get that stone, which is at the middle of the brain. In the occult, they'll say that brain is the brain up under the brain. And I was doing some mythology and also connected Cthulhu. If anyone knows about the Necronomicon mystery, Cthulhu basically ruled until he went to sleep in Relia or Rayleigh. And he sank. He's sunken at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. So they talk about this same Osirian thing, him being flooded over in this city that will rise, this crystal city that will rise. Now, Cthulhu can be looked at the hypothalamus gland with tentacles. If you were to look at the hypothalamus gland under X-ray, it looks like a ball with tentacles. It looks like Cthulhu. But the city it sleeps in is a crystal city, and we know the pineal has the pineal is nothing but a crystal. So, and also as the horse that as the vehicle, meaning you need your pineal to activate the brain up under the brain. The pineal is a god. Now I've seen things, and there may be more. And these are old notes that I'm going
right.
through.
Right. Well, also to correlate to that, we have the hippocampus area of the brain. In which that it actually, when hippocampus, when you break that word down, it means white horse.
Right. Okay. See that they see again. So these are these symbolic things, and then you see them in all of these movies where this guy, gets on this fucking horse in the middle of the movie. Like, why the fuck is he doing that? Because they're telling this story all the way through. So again, the beginning of. These symbols are the things to learn when you're dealing with this stuff, because everyone's always asking me, how do you decode these things? Well, you decode them when you deal with the mythology. And then when you deal with decoding the mythology, and you do it by making these connections with other mythologies, other stories. As I pointed out last week, most of us stop at Egyptian mythology, but we need to really understand all of this is our mythology. And if we could get understand the difference between archetype energy and symbology versus folklore. Folklore is nothing but that energy that is undeniable, just tailor-fitted for the culture. So when we see this King Arthur mystery, most people won't touch it. But you got to understand, it's still our ancient mythology, our ancient symbology, but it is the story and the names have changed and the images have changed on the surface based upon the folklore of whatever people who has to retell our story to make themselves to have something for them to use to transform themselves. So the correspondence is key. People ask me all the time, and you're seeing. In this show, why the correspondence is so key, because now each time you see a horse, you have you understand why this is happening. And at the end of the day, you practice with movies, because once you practice and start to be able to decode quickly in movies, that's only practice for your dreams, which is what you're actually supposed to be decoding and what these symbols actually mean. All right, so now. Arthur had the same enlightening experience as the archetypal god king who resided at the center of the underworld, or rather of the center of creation itself. So now that you say this center, you still could be talking about the pineal gland, but it still supports that hypothalamus gland at the center of the brain. And that sleeping hypothalamus gland that I pointed out was Cthulhu is also Osiris. And in the Arthur mystery, they're calling it the archetypical god king at the center of the underworld. We also know Osiris is the lord of the underworld. And as I pointed out, this Cthulhu, Osiris, same thing. What they're talking about is the resurrection of the sleeping god. That is also the quest for the Holy Grail. The quest represents the journey, the horse, or the task, as if Horus, Haru, their battle, or what they call the journey of the hero. That represents this quest for the Holy Grail, or like Jason and the Argonauts, their quest for the Golden Fleece, or Hercules and the 12 Labors. What they're constantly telling you in all mythologies, that you have a birthright as a human to, let me rephrase it. You're born into a quest as a human. You're born into a quest as a human. There is no chilling out here. If you are here, you have a male or female. It's the redeeming of the father, which is looked at as the sleeping father or the subconscious mind underworld. This thing keeps going. It's the same recycled thing. Now, and why he had this, because this archetypical hero whom Arthur was modeled. Now, when they're saying he's modeled after this archetype, that's what I just was talking about, that no matter what face it is, there's an archetype hero in every single story. You can't have a story without him. He's believed to be reincarnated on Earth of the first god. So when they say that, they're talking about your birthright. Your birthright is from that first god. Now, I pointed out last week that is represented as not just Osiris, but the first god is also represented by Set. Set right. ruled. When we were in power, you can look at the attributes of Set, which you can get in those books I pointed out by Marg Morton and Don Webb. Both of these
also,
guys write
Each of the Light of the World by Gerald Massey.
Uh-huh. Okay. Gerald Massey did something on it too. Okay, excellent. Like Set represents that old regime. And this old regime, there's nothing wrong with it in the classic evil sense. It's wrong because it represents the old you, and if you show up in a third dimensional place, the only reason you are here by birth alone is for a new quest to become the new. So that's why it's always the son, like King Arthur, trying to redeem the father, representing now what was the old you, the old wisdom, which became your subconscious mind. Yes, sir.
Oh, no, I just wanted to add, when we look at the King Arthur, he had his knights, his 12 knights around the round table.
Right.
You know, of course,
right.
that's symbolic to the pineal
right.
gland and the 12th pair of cranial nerves that sits
mm-hmm.
around the pineal gland, which is at the center of the brain. Of course, we know
uh-huh.
that the chorus, the French philosopher, that the soul is embedded inside of the pineal gland. So Heru symbolizes the awakened soul, while the sleeping soul symbolizes Osar, who's the lord of the underworld.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as
right.
you said, that subconscious plane. But upon awakening, you become conscious and the veil of mystery, you know what I'm saying, dissipates. And
mm-hmm.
when we look at that story, you know, that's the God in which they talk about, in which that created too, or that incarnated too, is talking about the soul incarnated inside of the body,
right.
called the temple of man. And all of the mythologies
right.
after that, Heru, you know, which is Osar or Set, Heru, you know, all of that comes after, and it's all based on that same signs as you're talking about. You know,
right.
Heru,
right.
there's no coincidence
right.
that Heru had 12 disciples. Jesus had 12 disciples. You know, King Arthur had his 12 knights. You know, the sun has its 12 zodiac signs. You know, once again, as above, so below, as within, so without.
Right. Oh, yeah. Most definitely, like, that when you get down to the mysteries of that 12, it's always represented as revolution, a circle. But that 13th, just like the sun hieroglyph, represents that point in the middle, which is that gateway out. So they always have the 12 Hercules, 12 labors, King Arthur, 12 at the round table. He always represents that 13th and is symbolic of you piercing through that circle of time. Like, for instance, we talked about the KR city. Or a city, which KR, last week we explained, meant head. So in the King Arthur mysteries, where they talk about this is the head, everything is talking about the head as the true place of the Holy Grail that he's questing for. It's embedded in the story of his quest that he's only looking for his head. And it's also, they also call this Sayar City the Revolving Castle. And remember, the castle represented the head. So the revolving castle is interesting because that's when you get into the 12 that you were just talking about. See, some researchers believe that the Celtic revolving castle is a metaphor to the processional cycle traced in the sky tilted on the Earth's axis. So, and that's the same nerves you were telling that were in the brain as well. Now, as above, so below, as you said, as we know, each zodiac has a different frequency that has an effect on the brain, thought, and pineal, and so on and so forth. Pisces, that we're just coming out of, was the age of belief, so everybody believed that something was greater than them, or Jesus, and so on and so forth. And we're coming in the age of knowing. When we're coming into the age of knowing, that's when the lecture scene rolled up. Knowing, knowledge is nothing but information, and that's when the information started coming. Everything was information, VHS, that DVD. You can get all the information you need coming as it was coming into this Aquarian age. Something in that revolving castle in your head, something seems to change in the brain, coinciding with the precession of the equinox. You get what I'm saying? So when they say Arthur sits around the round table with his 12 guys, that is the nerves that you pointed out in the brain. You get what I'm saying? With a different characteristic, the same way Jesus' disciples have different characteristics. It might have been you who used to teach this, but one of the teachers explained, well, the word disciple is just discipline. So it was about Jesus' disciples, meaning he just disciplined those 12 energies or those 12 circles to become the 13th, that middle point. And that middle point, or him as the Vesica Pisces, is how you get the hell up out of that gateway. So, of course, you could say that middle point or that round table, hypothalamus, but primarily more of this speaks to the pineal as the philosopher's stone. So that middle point is there. Some say that the revolving castle is also could be looked at as Stonehenge as well, a castle for time and a gateway out. And basically it's to define what disciple that we're in, disciple of Pisces, which is the same zodiac thing, and so on and so forth. So yeah, that most definitely lines up. You get what I'm saying? Most definitely lines up. Let me see. You know, of course, Arthur is just a straight Celtic version of Horus, you know what I mean? So it's the same story over and over, you know what I mean? Now, just another interesting fact that I came across and while I was studying this, many still believe the importance of the head lies in ancient custom whereby the warrior is beheaded by a victim. And by owning his head is like owning the energy. So I found that interesting statement because, and it's not really hard to do. Black people cannot realize for the life of them why they hear these rumors that the Skull and Bones drinks from the heads of like Geronimo and all of these and all of their enemies, because they're following straight ancient tradition. and they're using ancient energy. While we're saying it's physically disgusting, but they're drinking out these heads because this is their ritual. And it's something that we evidently used to do. This is our ancient belief system. You know what I mean? So that was interesting. Like I said, I'm going through my old notes as I go through this. So if you just jump in, you can jump
in. Yeah, it's some old Highlander shit.
Right, yeah, right. See, all of that sticks out in the author myth. Now, see, and I'm glad you interjected that because that's also an important reason to deal with what you think is theirs. Because since we think it is theirs, they let a lot of information out where we still dealing with the same couple of comedic books, you know what I mean, telling us the same story of Osiris over and over again. But you'll hear more in detail things. But the idea is, if you think you're just reading this as a straight read, you'll look at that and say, well, that's disgusting. Why are they cutting off heads and drinking out of them? But a lot of it's symbolic, and it's from us. And it's just a story to tell you the importance of what it is alchemically or what it is metaphysically that's happening here, drinking the energy of a vanquished foe. And somebody said, you don't really necessarily have to do it. Not saying nobody did that in the time where this was something to do, but Skull and Bones are doing it now. We, of course, do not have to do that. But of course, if you could decode this, you understand it's only talking about more importance of the head, and in this particular case, the Holy Grail and the head. And so, okay, and I'm going to keep going to give more symbology that speaks to the same importance of your true quest is an inner quest for this Holy Grail. The ancients observed the eyes of a snake never blink and were wide open at all times. Therefore, they believed the snake could see everything and knew everything. This observable phenomenon was also applied to the shining ones. A shamanistic-led race of certain beings who are known as the Watchers. Now, when I first started studying the Watchers, I started thinking it was the Demiurge. You know what I mean? They're hanging around watching us just suffer around this motherfucker just for this. And then they show you in like Silver Surfer these Watchers, and they show them in the Green Lantern. They're observing all of these fucking tragedies and doing nothing for their own benefit. But then, you know, then I started to quickly see, nah, the Watchers represent the ones with the same way the Egyptians pointed out with the Uraeus snake on the top of their head that's always out, that represents a watcher, someone who has constant ability or constant access to the pineal. That is also called a shiny one, which is serpent beings. When later on we trying to call these reptilians, that's us, the shiny ones. For two things, I'll tell you this, the Naga race. For two things, I can tell you this, and this can be accomplished now, because there was times I had to do things to activate the pineal for spiritual transmission, to try to contact whoever. There were things I had to do. I had to smoke maybe an herb pack, but eventually, your pineal just needs to be exercised. It just needs to do push-ups. Then after a while, you have constant pineal activity where it works in unison with your humanity, meaning I can talk to Martin Luther King right now, you get what I'm saying, without having to do nothing, without having to chant, sit in no position or any of that. That's when I started realizing I became a watcher. Not watching humanity, but always watching the spirit world, I have an eye constantly open. And as for the shining ones, I did that master cleanse for 4 days, and I started turning it gold. I started walking around gold. People were going, what the fuck happened to you? You look gold and shit. And I had to go eat some Chinese food real quick to turn that shit off. You know what I'm saying? So all of that is, they're talking about activating something. And then later, what I noticed was I was reading something from William Henry. If you don't know William Henry, he's a white boy, but he has pretty straightforward books where he breaks down a lot of mythology and does a lot of correspondence. So the subject of how we're dealing with this, how we're dealing with this subject tonight, if this is interesting and making connections for you, further reading is anything by William Henry, his style. He made the Oracle of the Illuminati, William Henry, Mary Magdalene, the Illuminator, William Henry, Cult of the, he also made Starwalkers in the Dimensions of the Blessed by William Henry, and his famous is Cloak of the Illuminati, which all of these, I mean, he'll break that, the Mayan symbols to the letter G, which is infinity, which is the Masonic G. I mean, he goes into very detail if you like this style of learning. Now,
right. Well, that one of the reasons, because he took a lot of my information, as well as probably Bobby's.
I'm sure of it. And see, I'm sure of it. See, most people, they need that book to back it up, but I'm sure of it. Like, in fact, to do even better, like I said, when I heard Aleem and then I'm able to read a lot of books because I started with a lot of black teachers, a lot of teachers that took what looks to be something great and unreachable, demystified it and made it your own once again. So when I hear what he's doing, a lot of people just need that book. But if you really want to get down to it, none of them said nothing that I haven't heard come out the mouth of us in one way or another. There's nothing I've ever read in the book, and let me make this clear, that I say, wow, I've never heard us touch on that. I've never heard none of us say that. It's just the same story said many different ways. Now, I do believe that is good because we learn through repetition. We learn through hearing the same thing at different angles. So I still think it's important to deal with these books, but we need to understand what we deal with. I've never heard any book supersede what I heard come out of any of my brother's mouths. Never. You get what I'm saying? And if it did contradict, it did whatever. But if I found the contradiction, I would have found that contradiction anyway, not because of the book. And that's fine because, remember, this is your journey at the end of the day. You vibrate with what you vibrate with. You get what I'm saying? So my personal revelation is when this thing was happening to me, the Shining One, and this and of course the Serpent Being is not too hard to figure. I will only stress that for those who think there's still some reptilian race that means to do harm to you. Now, what William Henry did and why I brought him up, because in one of his books, can't remember which one, he does a good job of defining the word netter and connecting it to the word watcher. There was one lecture I did, I can't remember what it was, where I went in detail between that when it was in front of me. But this watcher is also a netter. So it's something, and they looked at it as you can become a netteru, through alchemy, through doing the work. So it's a level that you achieve within your consciousness. And once he connected it to the watcher, which is something I was feeling, I said, oh, okay, there aren't this group of watchers as a demiurge that's looking over you. What's happening is you become this level of a watcher. You get what I'm saying? Meaning your eye has to open, your third eye has to open. You get what I'm saying? And that can be looked at as the philosopher's stone. You get what I'm saying?
I give a good example of that too, because my cousin got killed. He was murdered, mm-hmm. shot in Brooklyn after he was robbing the nigga. And you know, because of, you know, that shit that happened, I put him on my altar, you know, and I put a picture on there, and I started, you know, building with him, and, you know, and I told the ancestors, I said, yo, whenever he graduates to the next level of consciousness, yo, come and get me, you know, come and get me, you know, for I can watch. They came and got me, you know what I'm saying? Came and got me out my body. I went to his ceremony, and he was getting ready to walk up. It was like a damn soul train line and shit. And he was getting ready to walk up through the middle, but he was, like, intimidated. You know, he was timid. He was, you know, looking like, you know, how the hell I got here? You know, what, you know, but the ancestors on both sides of him was, like, just clapping and cheering him on and saying, yeah.
Right.
You know, through me communicating with him, you know, that helped him get, you know, from becoming
Absolutely.
A dead, what is that, dead relative to becoming a live ancestor.
Right.
You know,
Absolutely.
Right. You know, they gave him his robes of his clothes and everything, and I was
right.
And they talked to him, but the ancestor that was with me say, he can't hear you. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, you know, I was getting upset at him. I was like, damn, I should have damn put more, you know, I should have made it more relevant. Like, you know, I want to be able to talk to the nigga too or something. You know what
I'm saying? Right, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, that,
you
yeah.
Know?
See, that's perfect.
Right.
That, what you just, that is almost all you really have to do down here. One of the only things you really have to do. That is probably conceived from anything I've ever touched or dealt with. That's probably some of the greatest work you could do. All of that stuff about saving babies, that on a, let's just say on the metaphysical or occult level, is exactly that. And what you get back in return is off the hook. I'm glad you brought that story up. I had a friend. We knew each other when we grew up. We wasn't just in the same hood in Queensbridge. My man KL. KL had bad asthma. Now, around 99, me and him started hanging again. I started selling porno on the internet. The internet was new. I actually started in 97. So this was new. It was a new phenomenon. Let's say you was in Idaho. You know, there's no porn stores, you know, only in the big city. So this was the time to do this, and it was going down. Me and KL pretty much got a little bit closer then. KL was doing his album on Tommy Boy that was in a group called Screwball. Now,
remember
during
Screwball.
That time, huh?
I remember Screwball.
You remember them? Yeah, Screwball. Yeah. Now, during this time, all through these porns that I'm filming, you know, we screwballing it up. All right, so after the internet was crazy, was over, maybe about 2004, just happened to talk to KL. Yeah, what's going on? While I was talking to him, another guy who got killed in maybe the mid-90s named Lou just came to my head. So I was like, yo, remember Louie? You know, Green Eye Louie? Yeah, we talking. He's like, yeah, that's Screwball. I said, really? He said, yeah, that's what we named the band from, Screwball, and all of this, that. I said, all this time I didn't know, because they gave me, said, yeah, he's on our album and this and that. I said, yeah, well, he gave me, you know, I said, damn, you gave me a promo copy. I didn't know that was Lou. So got off the phone with KL. Lou comes through. He said, yo. He was about 20-something when he got shot, he said, and murdered. And everybody in the hood would say, Lou missed out on so much pussy because he had green eyes. That was the national anthem. Damn all the pussy he missed out on. He was green-eyed Lou. Damn, them green eyes have gotten so much pussy. So what he told me was all of that locked him still on Earth. He said he was actually like the best definition is like one of the lost boys. In between two worlds, but still connected because all of these people saying how much he missed out magnetically pulled him to Earth. He said, now, it was all the pussy and milkshakes you could get, but he was stuck. He said, when I was doing the porno and we were yelling out, Screwball, Screwball, calling on his name, all of that fucking and that energy snapped him out of it, and he moved the fuck on. Now, Lou was from 12th Street in Queensbridge, and if you know rap history, that's where the Mob Deep is from. His brother's in the Infamous Mob. Lou said he did all of that and raised all that Infamous Mob up and his area, Queensbridge, up. But he has moved on. Excellent story. Telling a friend of mine who understood, we sitting down eating. Soon as we sitting down eating, there's a white song. Louie, shit comes on the radio while we talking about Lou. I said, okay, Lou is here. Lou is telling me I looked out, got him, the pussy. Great job. That we were sitting down on that Sunday, on that Monday, the same friend I was sitting down called me and said, yo, KL just died. KL, the one who called me just a while ago to talk about Lou. I said, oh, this nigga just called me. I said, shit, well, he said he was starting a cigar company, so he wants a cigar. I'm like, damn, why didn't Lou, I wouldn't contact Lou again. Lou, what the fuck, son? He's like, well, I couldn't tell you. I knew he was coming. He said, this is what I want you to do. Because KL raised me up and helped me get between Earth and to move on past this realm, I'm going to bring him past this realm. I just need you to get them out the astral realm to me. I said, no problem. Me and KL used to drink 99 bananas, pour some of that, went into a hard meditation. And what I've seen is, and I'm trying to describe it best, that world looks, I guess you could say, two-dimensional, like the game Tron, the original game. Now I'm going through there, and I could see that light that everyone's talking about. I knew that was just astral light. We stay in maneuvering, and then I seen a little light, which was his soul. And that little light is what we started going towards. And right. I'm still awake while I'm doing this meditation. While I'm doing this meditation, I see and bring him there. He says, thank you. Let him go. Now, as I go to sleep, this nigga comes through hard. Oh, I never knew. He wasn't conscious of nothing. He was just a good nigga. I never knew we was Egyptians. I never knew we was this. I never knew this and that. I said, yo, look, just tell me your name, and when you ready, just get back at me. Came back, said, my name is Ta'ankh Nefa. Wrote it down, said, I got you. Now, KL was the type, anyway, KL was the ultimate hustler. And a couple of days when I went to his wake, Marley Marl, Pete Rock, what's the boy, Premier, all of them niggas eulogized him. Marley Marl eulogized him. Marley Marl's word was, this nigga always knew how to formulate. I was in this game for 20 years, and he always had a fresh idea. That's who KL was. So KL came with, after a while, started working with KL. See, because when you do these things, you make these people your allies now. You got them out of prison. It's simple as that. So KL was the one, he introduced me in the spirit world to Oscar Meshore. Oscar Meshore was, he was the Spike Lee of 1900 and such and such. He was very conscious, and his movies dictate. Don't ask me to spell his last name. Oscar Meshore. And when he came through, he told me all about all that shit we talked about, chemtrails, this, that, that. He said, none of that works. The only thing that's been working is movies. And, you know, he was saying simple shit. Because people said, well, they're going to cut off the electricity, and we're going to be in the dark. He said, why would they ever do some shit like that? Niggas in the dark with a pineal gland, they must keep it going in the movies. You know, so he went through this whole thing, was informed, and gave out what I gave out at the time. KL is also the one who said, you need to start selling herb packs, and all of that happened. So, but by talking to them, what they give back, based upon the little bit of meditation you as a conscious person, does for them, is immeasurable. So if you have some dead dumb niggas in your family and you are conscious, the absolute goal here is to absolutely get them out of the astral world or stuck with whatever they stuck. Make contact with them and show them how to move on. I'm glad you brought up this subject. I know it's a little bit off the topic, but I'm glad you brought up this subject because
it deals with the pineal gland and with the science of
right,
melanin.
Right.
You know, so
right,
we all
absolutely.
To think we
right,
are.
Right. Yeah, I'll take that one. I'll take that one. So, yes, it is that's one of the biggest things you do because you got to remember – you got to look, you're right, it is on topic because even through death in the astral world, it's still represented as that quest. You get what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, you're looking to go home. You get what I'm saying? You're looking to find rest. So if you're in the astral world, you can build a house there, which is just another version, is just a lighter version of an illusionary world, and eventually you will get sucked back into a body. And or you can move beyond this realm, which is the ultimate goal. You get what I'm saying? And a lot of people who are not aware of it don't know how to do it. You get what I'm saying? There was another thing, and I'll make it really quick. Never met this guy, but Bobby Hemmett told me about him. He said there was a brother named Metahochi. He told me that he got an Obatala ritual from Metahochi that worked immediately. He said Metahochi was the first guy to start revealing secrets of Ifa. He said once Santeria became big, people now, which its origin is in Ifa in the Yoruba people, but it, since it went to these islands, Santeria came back with most Cubans, Puerto Ricans, and so on. So when black people started getting a whiff of this and finding out that it had an African origin, they turned their attention to Nigeria. But those Nigerian Babalawos weren't giving up any information. Meta Hochi was one of the first to work with these so-called African Americans and to start dealing with the mysteries of Ifa, and that's when all of these houses, these African Ifa houses started showing up based upon him. Now, this is what Bobby's telling me. So this guy passed, and he was badass and all the rest of that. He said, see if you could get in contact with Meta Hochi. Sure enough. Did whatever I was doing, got under meditations. When I'm awake, Meta Hochi comes. He was like, yeah, you don't remember me. I was like, no, hell no, I don't remember your ass. He's like, yeah, I remember you. He said, I wonder if you changed. So I'm hitting him with all this dumb shit. Oh, change is the name of the game down here. He said, look, motherfucker, I wonder if your heart changed. The nigga came in and started sniffing my heart. He's like, oh, okay. And then fell asleep. This nigga took me to a whole drumming world, a world of nothing but drummers. It was fucking off the hook. Everywhere I went, motherfuckers was just drumming on everything, waiting for, getting prepared for this nigga to make this procession his welcome home. So he invited me to this shit. Now, well,
that,
I'm there.
Happened with my cousin. That's what I'm talking about. They was damn clapping.
Right,
and
you
yelling.
See
that?
Right. Yeah, you see,
in the
you
background.
Get around. Right, you get a, you see, right, you see this crazy, it's a fucking party, like, it's farther than the eye can see. The closest I've seen, and I know George Lucas deals with astral work, so the closest interpretation was how they do at the end of Star Wars, where they have these celebrations, and everyone's out, and but this, and that's really a cheap rendition of what you actually see based
right.
upon you cannot do it. It's not, this world is not conducive to even that type of thing. You know what I'm saying? So how I knew it was true, because when I had Orisha girlfriends, you know what I mean? The Orishas used to always try to get my ass, you know, try to get me to put on some head wrap shit. You know what I'm saying? But I always resisted, because if I would have been locked down in that Orisha shit, we couldn't be talking about what we're talking about today. So earlier,
yeah,
I know,
because my head is a botula, and they was like, you need to wear white. You need to
yeah,
wear white.
Yeah, same shit. Like I see a botula thing. A botula came to me on a lot of occasions. I'll tell you an Abatala thing that happened. It was real big. And really, people have been asking for me to tell it. I'm going to tell as much as I could. But the first time she took me to a drumming, I was just reading light metaphysics. Everybody was in there bumping me, doing dumb shit. They were doing, you know, falling out. So I asked, came back to her father's a badass Babalawo. He got made in Nigeria. Off the fucking chain, you know what I'm saying? And so I came back, I asked the pops, I'm like, the fuck was they doing that for? So he's talking to me like, I got some religious issue. Yeah, the first time I went, I held up my cross. I said, no, you, wait a minute, let's get this shit straight. Like, I don't know nothing about no Jesus. My parents ain't in the Jesus. And this is what's really rare. My grandparents on both sides ain't from church. Usually if your parents ain't from church because they tired of their parents' shit, your grandmama and them taking you. I'm a couple of generations out of that shit. So nothing in me was ever, I got to overcome this shit. You get what I'm saying? So I'm like, I think he realized I wasn't asking because I was just, they was just so powerful and this, and you know, I'd never seen Jesus do this. He would say, I'm asking like, why the fuck they running around acting stupid? You know what I'm saying? One nigga running around, jumping around. Who are you a child of? They all had that same African voice. You know what I'm saying? Like that same fat, fake-ass English African voice. Like, my girlfriend's brother's girl came to me. Who is this one you bring? I'm like, what the fuck is she talking like that for? You know what I'm saying? I can see she's not really possessed. And I'm like, yeah, my girl said, well, his parents, you know, his people are from New Orleans. Ooh, do you know what this means? I'm like, why is she talking like this? So I'm asking him shit like that. He picked up on it. And he said, let me tell you, Sean, he said, niggas going to do what niggas going to do.
Right.
I said, oh, that's real. Then he said, I'm going to tell you, the drummers are the ones that know. He said, for instance, if, let's say someone said Shango comes down on their head. He said, and they're doing this, he said, the drummers start drumming a certain way and start having a conversation with Shango, giving them instructions. He said, if it's really Shango, then the person who says Shango's on their head will do it without them knowing. The average Joe wouldn't know. It's the science they teach the drummers. I said, okay, so now he's telling me some science. And then he said, here's a couple of books, this, that, the other. So I said, okay, but I started having dreams. The motherfuckers were trying to attack me. And then I started running across Bobby's information. Some of the earliest things he was saying was, the fucking Orishas ain't your friend. And I said, don't you fucking know it. Like, the girl was just out of mind. You couldn't be naked in front of none of the pots. I'm like, the niggas who created this shit was naked. Couldn't fuck, couldn't curse, couldn't do what. It was hypo-religious. When she went to get made, she cut off all her hair, got married to Obatala, couldn't fuck for a year, but couldn't even touch, couldn't even hug no kid for a year. Had to turn on the makeup.
That's
just
the same thing. Saved by Jesus shit.
Yeah.
I'm saving my pussy for Jesus.
Right, yeah. Oh, you're right. Right.
Jesus,
and then this gets worse. And this is worse because you justify it with some African shit. You get what I'm saying? So now you're doing it for your people. You want to step ahead. So, I mean, it's totally insane and really not necessary.
I mean, Jesus
time.
Black could change his name to a Bacala.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Like, man, when I tell you it was just insane, but it was spiritual that I went through that experience because 9 times out of 10, your first thing said, well, I want to be spiritual. The first thing you go is to an Orisha house. You know what I'm saying? So when I seen that and with still dealing with metaphysics, when I wanted to so-called be spiritual, I already knew what time it was with that. Now, and even a lot of stuff, even like, there's so many Orisha stories of them attacking me. Shango and them niggas attacked me. To them niggas just said, yo, I give up. And Obatala came. Now, even before that, the father, like, she took me to her godfather to get a reading, straight shyster, saying bullshit like, the bucket is half full and half empty. I'm like, well, that's for everybody. Well, this, that, the other, just all regular shit. I'm like, nah, I'm some bullshit. Now, so she said, wait a minute, you need a reading from my pops. Now, our pops got made in Nigeria. Our pops was badass. When there was a blackout in New York, I was at her house. She wasn't home. The cells was down. The pop stood in the windowsill, said, she's at a friend's house. I'm like, what? I wasn't believing that shit. Sure enough, she's like, yeah, I was at my friend's house. He said, she's at a friend's house, a girl. Co-worker, she went to her house, spent the night. There was also something else that did happen. And when I was downstairs at her crib, I'm worried. That's my girl. The whole New York was dark. We in the next day. I walked past her pots, the Marisha pots. I had the overwhelming feeling that she was okay. One of the strongest feelings from the spirit world. What I do know now is you pledge yourself to that Orisha, they will take care of your ass. But you're going to be taking care of their ass for sure, pouring them 24 glasses of water, feeding them at every goddamn possible moment you put something in your mouth. So they will take it, and they showed me that shit. So it's not like the Reach of the Will and Paolo is better. It's all real. It's just the agreement you have with them. Now, when I did the reading with our pops, this is what our pops said. At the time, all I was doing was still studying for my computer shit. He said, you came to planet Earth to teach. I'm like, what, computers? He said, you didn't want to come to Earth. Somebody came and asked you to come to Earth. I found out later on it was actually Bobby Hemming, just to come and do what I'm doing. And
yeah, just
like somebody asked me.
Yeah, but just like he got my ass doing this now.
Yeah. So apparently Bobby does that. You know what I'm saying?
Last week.
Yeah,
I was on the Fulton County Library down in Atlanta when I was living down in 94, 95, And he was like, man, I wish there was, you know, other people doing this like me. And they looking at straight at me. And I'm like, okay, Bobby, I'll do it. So
it pulled me in. Even now, because, like, you know, my whole thing was like, I just want to study. So me and Bobby became like, yo, Bobby, I'm studying this. Any books, any that, just to share information. He started saying, well, why don't you do a couple of them blog talks? Nah, I'm not really into it. I'm good. I want to study. So this Bob Alive was telling me early on, you was chilling. I found out later that I was chilling in the motherfucking Palladium system, just living it up. That's where most of the jazz comes from. The jazz niggas in Palladium. That's where it was fun. That's why I'm not even into jazz. I know what it means. I'm not into jazz now. I was in Palladium just chaosing it up with Ella and them niggas. And this nigga said, you need to come to Earth. I'm like, Earth, nigga? Come on. Because you got to understand, I did find out that we went through what you call this Holocaust already.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. So the ones who could come and retain their sense, let's just say, which you could just look at as the conscious people, have been through this for real, for real. Now, this is what C. Freeman L. told me when I contacted him. There's avatars. Some people's actual light fall to Earth. Some people do not, their soul do not fall to Earth, but they project the avatar. Project the avatar. Bobby,
right.
then he told me, remember when Bobby used to do those lectures and said, I can show you the star in the sky that follows me.
Shit, that's
and
why
then,
we was on the foot himself on libraries because we was looking for the damn star in the UFO and shit.
Now, what C. Freeman L. told me was, no, that's Bobby's soul that he's looking at. That's why it follows him. He's projected himself on planet Earth, but he hasn't fallen, the true fallen. That's why we can retain a certain amount or a certain level of consciousness, because our soul isn't buried and recycled in time like most of what we call the dead or the aware down here. That's a master revealing from C. Freeman L. And then he pointed me to Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda and them niggas who were teaching that, how they were seen, known as avatars, not as fallen souls. C. Freeman L.
Vivekananda,
most conscious
he was one of my teachers to Sanyata Saraswati, one of my teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that definitely falls right in line.
Master revealing. So
right.
This Bob Alive told me all this shit. You'll do better than nature. He told me you'll always be protected by the feminine energy. He told me a whole bunch of shit that I just had no clue about and all come to pass and should have wrote that shit down. Shit that I would remember rarely and just say, like Brother Will, the astrologer. He said, remember when you told me that Bob Alive told you that you'd be writing? I said, I forgot all about that. And on MySpace, all I did was write blogs. In fact, that's what actually got my core people who even interested in my shit through my blogs. Then it eventually turned into talking and so on and so forth. Now, so I said, yeah, that nigga said all of that would happen. And, of course, I got a book coming and all the rest of that. So this Bob Alive was badass. Ifa reading is different from a regular reading because they read what they call your Ori, which is on your head.
Right,
and so you, it comes right, you come down here with this. Now, when I dealt with Jimi Hendrix, he told me something similar. What he told me, or he broke that down in a different way. What he told me was there are like archetype energies in the astral world. Now, so basically, most people fall into these energies and they wake up who the fuck, whoever the fuck they are. You get what I'm saying? Through these life cycles. But as a conscious master, you can pick what's on your head so it's in harmony with what it is you came down here to do. For instance, Jimi Hendrix and all the rest of these guys said, no, we pick who he was going to be when we came down here, so we know we can live according to our mission down here. Most people are just falling into what we call these Ori. You get what I'm saying? And they could just be anything. That's why this world is insane. But see, in the ancient day, and I think I was talking a little bit about last week, the caste system, if you were a from warrior father, you're going to be a warrior, because this would be in line with what we call in the Ori, or be in line with what this energy stream that you're being birthed to, so you can live in harmony with your goal here. You get what I'm saying? With your goal here. Before the caste system became a racist, a way to deal with racism. It just became, if you were born to it, as good as that, because the caste system has looked at the entire body of Brahma. So there was no way one could be less than the other. It just represented as his body. So he also said, as you put, like, Obatala was on the head. So now, as we moved on, and one of the first pantheons I would deal with, this is because of Bobby Hemmett, was those 11 Palo Miombe deities that were compiled by Carlos Montenegro in a book called Palo Miombe, which is right. Now out of print.
Right.
Now. Or you can buy it for $300. I do sell that book. Oh, let me put this out right now, middle of the show, before we get to questions. Herb packs, chant CDs, spiritual baths, a couple of out-of-print books, Cyclomancy, The Power of Psychic Control, the Palo Miombe book, all those things I sell. What you need to do is email me for a list. Email me at panicpack@hotmail.com, PANICPACK, to get a list. If you don't know what the herb pack is because you haven't listened to other shows that I've done, I want to send you a list of other shows that I've done so you can hear what it is first before you get into it. But it's all natural herbs, no drugs, nothing on the piss test, everything you can eat that work on your pineal. It helps to decalcify your pineal and help within. Everyone who's used it has a different experience. It stops chatter in their head. People's dreams are deeper. People focus on their music more. Everyone seems to have a success story. This has been going on for 2 years already. So this is old hat. This is not a new experiment. So you need to get you one of those. If you are first hearing about it, also let me know that in your email so I can give you some back information. Most people have been hearing about it and finally getting around to it, so I said all I had to say on it. So that's just email me at panicpack@hotmail.com. And we'll give you a list from there, and it's something you need to do in your life. Now,
because I just got mine, so you better get yours.
Yeah. Okay, you did. I didn't know if you tried that. I sent a lean one, and you know, so he could get his trial. But it also, you don't have to just smoke it. You could drink it as a tea as well. So if you don't want to smoke, drink it as a tea. So you know, again, just give me an email, and we'll do it from there. Now, so that first pantheon was the Palos. Now, Rudra said, Panic, when you deal with the Palos, the Orishas are going to attack you. I'm like, they was attacked. You can look at it. They was attacked because I used to have dreams when I was in the bed with this girl and all this stuff when I was with this Orisha girl. We were broken up about a year, maybe a year and a half, and he said, they're going to attack you. He said, there's a liquor called Palo Viejo. You can't get it everywhere. Maybe a few states have it, but New York is one of those states. And believe you me, until I moved out here, I was the main supplier guy. Send me one of them Palo Viejos. It's the liquor of the Palos. The Palo means stick. Palo Viejo means tall sticks. The Palo spirits are caught in Palo sticks. So you would use the sticks for certain things. They break down the stick in that Carlos Montenegro book. Now, so I would take some of the Palo sticks. I got a girl named Jackie. She has a botanica. You know something? Let me give out Jackie's botanica number because she does mail out. Because people always ask me later, how could I get this, that? So she's a botanica. Tell her Panic sent you. And let me give out her number. Her number is 718-498-8300. That's for the Palo sticks, or if you're having trouble finding stuff from Botanica statues, maybe she can help you out. That's 718-498-8300. But those Palo sticks, people have already hit up for those Palo sticks. Now, you can put those Palo sticks, even if you have regular vodka, you can use some of those Palo sticks, sit them in that bottle, that gallon or that quart of vodka, and then charge your liquor with some of those Palo spirits, even if you can't get the Palo Viejo. Now, I put a little under the bed. Shango Kump came and started attacking. St. Martha, whose energy is active right now, she came and said, Shango wants your solar plexus. I'm like, what? He said, there's no real fighting or war in the world. So Shango had to feed and sit on the black man's solar plexus as a form of aggression. Black on black crime is what your beloved Shango was feeding off of. After that day of dealing with St. Martha, instead of handling my issues with the fuck you looking at and all that shit, I started handling them magically because I released Shango from my solar plexus. Remember, understand, I know you got a beloved, he's a thunder god, but you got to look at it. The just causes he was created for no longer exist on Earth. War is manufactured. It's not a just war. There was a time when there was war between us and both tribes would call on Shango and he would be on the side of the just. Now it's some made up George Bush financial shit. So it doesn't exist. They have to survive. They went to black on black crime. Now that's the first time I said that because I know it's going to hurt a lot of folk. Now I released them, went to Philly, went to an orgy. The next day Katrina happened, St. Martha rose up and so on and so forth. And while he was attacking, my fucking stove blew out. The fuses blew out in my house that week. We couldn't get a fucking fuse for this shit. And we was in the fucking dark for a week. The stove was all fucked up. The bathtub was all fucked up. I said, wait a minute. I plugged something in there, my altar, that shit blew up. My aunt gave me a waterfall. Plugged the waterfall in, that shit blew up. I said, oh, hell the fuck no. Did some shit to St. Martha. The fuse came back on to this day. You know, when I was living there three, four, 5 years later, I never even knew how that shit started working again. Got all that shit taken care of one by one. I said, damn, that nigga tried to attack. This was early on before I was able to channel. Years later, Obatala came to me. I started to know that they come to me because my girlfriend, who was also under Obatala, the ex-girl, I would see her in the dreams first. The first contact was this. When I see my old neighborhood, Queensbridge, it always represents in my dreams that I'm outside of the actual world, that I'm in the real home. Because there's people who I've done work for, and I find I leave them in my old neighborhood, which means a certain part of their energy is home, because it represents home to me. So she's there, Obatala sitting on the chain, you know, the project. And he's telling me telepathically, we fucked up. Now, let me give you a little history. Bobby was, at this time, used to say in the lectures that the Orishas are now demiurge. Just like we went crazy, they went crazy. They are, based upon, you could just tell based upon the insanity of the people that these deities are now insane. Now, he went on to tell me later on, well, you got to remember, Oshun has 23 paths. Most of these people are coming to Oshun. Just coming to her for petty love squabbles, trying to keep their man, trying to keep their woman, trying to keep somebody in check instead of this real love thing. Now, so there's another word, still within this Orisha energy, there's still a level that you can reach based upon pure thought. But this insanity in worshiping has let these, let's just say, lower paths run amok. So the idea here is that we weren't dealing with the Orishas at that time. That energy is going crazy. As far as they're concerned, they were enemies. That Shango stuff that happened to me proved it for me when Brother Rudra was saying it was going to happen and what Bobby was saying. I already knew from dealing with this crazy family in their house that these motherfuckers was insane and everybody that they knew and showed up for birthday cake was just as insane as them. So I already had this idea, but when Obatala came to me personally, he said, I've seen the world that you have got coming. We should have never abandoned y'all. Now, what also happened to these Orishas was because we isolated them. And see, you got to remember, there was hundreds, thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of African spiritual systems in Africa. So the energy of love, Oshun, had many different names. If you don't believe me, get the book that Bobby's been talking about forever, and you will never finish this, called The Dictionary of Ancient Deities by Patricia Turner and Charles Russell Collier, C-O-U-L-T-E-R. You will see just how many love deities exist on this planet. Now, the Orishas were created by the Yoruba people in a religion called Ifa to serve those people. So by the time you get to worldwide consumption, you got to remember what this energy is. It is a thought form. And usually they're created by shamans, so the thought is pure. So the rules in the culture are strict, so the thoughts could be right and correct, and the deity could serve with its same intention. If that's why they didn't do it with foreigners and with ignorant people who weren't ready. That's why they had initiation systems, because they were bringing people to the point where they can deal with the deity without bringing their human bullshit into it, without bringing the ego into it, without asking for rent. You get what I'm saying? The idea was, well, they didn't need rent, but to hold the village down and hold the weed, there was a god for that. They never had to say, well, let me get good weeds, God. No, there was a system of appeasing that god for good weeds. And if you didn't do it, or if the weeds were bad, they would look at it as you didn't appease that god. You didn't ask, like, Oshun, let me find a boyfriend. Ogun, help me with some rent. That's corrupt thoughts. But then that deity, because this is all about your head, all about your thoughts, that deity becomes just as ignorant and becomes just as fucked up as we are, and that's what you have. And with now their energy is against you. Now they're feeding off of you. That's why these motherfuckers can't stop praying, bowing, stepping 13 times. Just, you drop a penny, you got to step on it. You look up, you look to the left, you got to turn right 3 times. You got to do all of this because you are, it's now a symbiont relationship of crazy. So Obatala, them niggas know that. And that's what he was apologizing for. When I got up, I said, oh, shit, that was Obatala. He apologized. This was in September of, I'm trying to get these years right, 2007. Now, no, 2006. And Bobby told Bobby about it. He said, the same thing happened to me. Obatala came to him, this world, that this world, you know, is off the hook and it's this, that, the other. That was in September 2006. And in November or maybe early December, Bobby Hemmick calls me. And he said, this is after this Obatala dream. He goes, man, I did a lecture, finished, got to the airport, and my plane was delayed. So I called the lecture. People said, look, I'm stranded. They said, okay, go to brother such and such house. Brother such and such house, he visited him while he was there. The dude had a ranch, had all these spirits, and had a lot of Orisha spirits, too. So Bobby was saying, look, when I went there, I'm like, oh, shit, all this shit I done talked about them fucking Orishas, and I'm about to walk in this house. He said, but the energy was cool. So now after he's stranded, the lady said, well, you can spend the night at such and such house. Now Bobby's telling me, he's going, oh, shit, man, I got to sleep in this motherfucker with these Orishas? This is going to be some bullshit. So he said he went. Dude made the bed up for him, said, since Obatala was on Bobby's head, too. He said, Bobby said he used to wear the white and all that shit. And he said when he was fucking with Obatala, he used to hear this ringing in his head. He said as soon as he walked in the room, he heard that fucking ringing in his head. I said, oh, shit. I was just pitying him. He said, but the Orishas came and said they wanted truce with him. Right. They said they couldn't, early on, they said they couldn't even see. They don't even see you as an individual. They only see light. They can only look at light. It's like us looking at a bunch of ants. So if we see in a pile of ants, if we see a red ant against a yellow ant against, that one will stick out. You get what I'm saying? So the spirit world doesn't see you. They only see light. That's why you say, well, how come all of this is happening to our people? We all spiritual, got all these spirits. Because they don't even see these people. Because they don't have no light, you get what I'm saying, based upon the sludge of humanity. So you got to gain light for these spirits to even see you exist. You get what I'm saying? So they said they started to see his light. Oya started to see his light, he said. And Bobby used to tell how they used to attack him. So now, so I'm like, okay, you know, all right. He said they wanted this truce. He said Ogun stopped the plane. We know he sits over iron. They said they want this. So when he's telling me, I'm like, fuck all of that. Them niggas did enough to me. I should put it like this. I'm not going to try to channel them. I'll see if they come to me. So this was, I had the Obatala September. This is 06. End of 06, November, Bobby tells me this. In December of 06 as well, right on New Year's, my father moved down south with my sister in South Carolina. And boom, she calls, he had an aneurysm. Everybody goes up, flies down, drives down. He's out. You know what I'm saying? So now, so the nurse tells me, if this man wakes up from this, it will take him 10 years to learn how to wipe his ass again. I said, damn. So I'm doing shit, calling on ancestors, time for him to make that move. You know what I mean? My sister, that, you know, my regular human sister, ooh, what would it take? They said, ma'am, it will take a miracle for him to ever open his eyes again. Y'all need to make arrangements. We go to his house. They automatically trying to give me collections of shit. Well, he's got a card collection. You know, give me his Masonic awards and shit. You know, it was done. They threw all his shit away. It's TV. It's porno. They said, keep the suit. That's what he was a goner. You know what I'm saying? Keep the suit. So we all went home, and this is December. We spent New Year's out there. You know, I'm doing all this ancestor shit. January, this nigga wakes up with a full recovery. Talking about, when am I going home? What do you mean you threw my shit away?
So important. Where my shit at?
Yeah, where my shit at? This nigga hit me on the phone. I had silverware for Thanksgiving. I'm like, dog, I got the Masonic Awards. You want those back and your Zippo lighter that I remember, a couple of them banners and pins and shit. Them niggas took the cards. Them niggas took the goods. You got to speak to them, dog. So now
man, where the fuck my porno collection at?
Yeah, my porno collection. You know, niggas was in his porno, up in his pono. So I'm like, yo, dog, wasn't me. You know what I'm saying? Finally, it wasn't me. All the shit I did that I got my ass whipped for, finally, it wasn't me. You know what I'm saying? I give you everything I got. It wasn't me this time. You need to talk to Reese. You need to talk to Lyle. You know what I'm saying? So he has his full recovery. I'm actually pissed because I'm thinking I'm calling on everything in the universe to smoothly bring his ass out. So now, and I'll get to what was actually happening. So in April, he's up. We moving back to New York on Roosevelt Island where my sister lives. There's two hospitals, so he's right near the family. He's up watching movies, talking about when I'm getting home. He's, like, happy now. Oh, I'm going to get a free check now. I'm stacking that. And I'm like, this shit is, I just didn't get it. So now in April 1st, I'm about to go to sleep, and Oshun comes hard. Now, this type of transmission, I've been able to shut it down because I used to have these and I used to hate them. These are the ones where they take me out of time. And I spoke about this is the most annoying shit. You'll be getting a transmission for what seems to be an hour. You look at the clock and be 7 minutes later. You close your eyes. You're out of time. And it's powerful. You feel intense pressure. I had these a couple of fucking times. And though the transmission is profound, Ella Fitzgerald, Louis Armstrong did that. My grandfather did that. And just on a Halloween once, when that gateway is thin, they did. The wind was blowing, and I could see spirits walking on the wind. But I don't really like those transmissions. It's just too taxing, if you will. But Oshun came on this night. She gave me a lot of information. And usually when they come, this is what Oshun said. Like, I wasn't at the point. I was at the point where St. Martha had to tell me what Shango was doing. But at this point, I was a channeling nigga. Oshun came through and said, look, what I've been doing was eating off of porno. I said, well, that's really not bad. And she said, well, it's bad if you was a love goddess. I said, damn. She said, I raised a lot of those of my daughters in that porno. I said, I already know what you're talking about, because there's some porno you watch, you can see this chick is trying to get a check, and some porno you watch, this chick is in it for the dick. The check is just extra. She said, some of those are my daughters. She said, but this is bad because I was a love god. And they're talking in a shameful way. And I'm like, damn, okay. And she's like, look, in the future, I'm going to marry Ogun. I'm like, okay. She said, we need work and love to build the new world you're in. Okay, I'm missing something. Let me go back before we get to this April 4th. In March, I had a dream. In the dream, they was bringing my father out in a wake. Other witnesses was there. My aunts was doing it. He already had the white beard and the white hair in real life. So everybody wants their father to be Obatala and their mother to be Oshun. But this was the Obatala nigga for real. But his beard was more pronounced. Like, you know, they have that fake Jew long beard shit, big white afro, you know what I'm saying? And arm was falling off the table. Niggas is yelling, they should have did something better for him. I'm like, so when I woke up, I said, well, perhaps, I said, this is it. Because he had a major stroke. So I'm thinking, finally, he's going to make the transition. He held on and da, 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 da. So when I went to the Botanica that day, same one I gave out the number, I seen the statue of Obatala, he came through. Obatala said, I went through that gateway of transformation. Now remember, Obatala is the chief Orisha. And he's like, I went through that gateway of transformation. I did it. And I said, oh, he was coming because he's trying. Because remember, everything down here must transform. Except any energy that's eaten off of this motherfucker, they're not going to want to transform. The Orishas are eating off of this motherfucker. If you look at the book, I pointed out the Dictionary of Ancient Deities, most of them are gone and forgotten, but in that goddamn book are maybe two others, which means there's nothing for them to hold on to because no humans are calling on them for anything so they could transform. What you got is stragglers behind. And since people are feeding the Orishas, spiritually fucking the Orishas, this girl cut her hair off, married to Obatala, couldn't touch nothing for a year. When people are doing that, they're fortifying these energies and they can't transform. You get what I'm saying? They need to become something new just like we need to become something new. So they're holding on to this realm. So it was big when Obatala made that transformation and he brought me there as a witness to this. So now from March to April is when of course Oshun came. So what she was saying to me was, now that Obatala has transformed, we all have to transform. But if these people know that a lot of their hardship ain't got nothing to do with the white man, that a lot of it is us, we know they're going to punish us once they get back in that position. I said, no. It's not up to them. It's up to us. If we transform you into something new, what is left behind is nothing but shadows, which still can serve you. So, in other words, you can call on Oshun now, but you still will get what it is you're trying to get because there's a template of a shadow there. The real energy has moved on, and it's supposed to. That's not a bad thing. It's really not deep. It's just moved on. So you can use those names. She gave me her new name and all of this. She's like, we don't trust you. She said, the worst thing in all the known universe, known and unknown, is becoming a human. You're going to do to us what happened to y'all. I said, no. Remember now, as I pointed out, they could not see people as individual, just lights. But it would, so for me to have this particular level of conversation is a big deal with anything from the Orisha family. Is a big deal. And this, again, this is based on alchemy work. Like I said, I don't want to make it sound like I'm bragging. Anybody can do it. You just got to put in that work. I was obsessed with this level of work. Let me say that so we are clear. I was obsessed with doing this type of thing. So if you create that obsession, you can do anything and greater. So it doesn't make me more special that I came from a meteorite, but this is a special thing that was happening at this time in 07. So I explained to her, no, once we transform you out, because she's looking at the masses of us as a whole. I'm like, no, the masses of us have this idea of this white man is the bad guy, and when they see that doesn't really exist in any other place but this world, and even that's illusionary, because we still can tell black people, look, you really could still come off without him, and that illusion doesn't exist, the attention will go to them. So no, once we transfer you out, you see what we're going to do with Obatala. I said, just watch what we do with Obatala, blah, 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 blah. So right after that, Ogun comes through. Tell this nigga, yo, you need to make it quick. Now, what I would say, I asked Oshun, you need to show me that it's really you. What she did was sat me on her lap. To this day, the best way I could describe that was, if you're in love with someone and you know how y'all just have that, where y'all just sit on the couch and watch a movie, enjoy each other, not necessarily about getting sex or sex, but you at such a comfort level, that a thousandfold. It was like just, oh, just sitting there. Then I knew I wasn't fucking with no chump. And again, this is one of the things that took me out of touch. So Ogun comes through, and he's saying, like, look, you know, there's no work, real work here. Because before, work on this planet was you reap what you put some seeds in the earth, what you put into that comes back as a fucking banana. Right now, everyone's just for some corporation, money isn't real, so he can't eat. What he's been eating off of is that feeling you get when you walk into work and punch that fucking time clock and got to sit there where every nigga on the planet are about to go into the plantation. He fed off of that and slavery. Ogun, I know this is radical, but hey, you know what I mean? If you grown, you can take it. And I said, okay, you know, oh, that's forgiven. He said, what's going to happen in the future? We need to transform to build a new world. It's going to be a marriage between me and Oshun, blah, 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 blah. And it was maybe more stuff I can't remember, but that was the most relevant. Now, nothing, this was in April. So, and also I asked him, well, you need to let me know this is your. Tell me something I don't know about y'all. He said April 1st, April Fool's Day is the leg buzz day. He's closest to the earth right now. That's why we're talking to you. Now, you got to understand why Alegba was the chief, the hardest one to get to in this, because every single Orisa ritual that you do starts with Alegba. He sits at that gateway. He sits at that gateway, or he sits right at that pineal, at your pineal gland. To get into that world, you have to appease Alegba. So he ain't trying to move shit. You get what I'm saying? He's the hardest, but it's going to have to trickle down. So I was waiting for him to Alegba. You know what I mean? And you still here? You still hear me, bro?
Yeah, we on here.
Okay. I thought I lost it. Now, what I'm do now, I'm looking for my notes, because I'm going to let you know exactly what I wrote down.
All right. I'm going to let you look for that, but we got some questions, too. So I'm going to go to the lines right quick, and as you're looking, you can answer these questions, too, just in case. Let me go to 757 area code. You're on the air. 757.
Peace.
Yo.
Peace to the gods.
Peace.
Peace, almighty.
Yo. Shouts out, yo, to you, Panic, and Brother Arlene.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, no doubt. I just wanted to shout you out, Panic, on something you had said previously about, you know, like a deity sitting over, like, that deity that sits over, like, this, you know, the struggle or whatever, you know, the racism and all that, black on black.
Right. Shango.
Yeah.
At that time, let me, if you don't get this in, let me say this. All of the Orishas have now transformed. And based upon the work I did with them, some of the work that Bobby put in with them. So this story I'm telling, it has a happy ending. If we don't get to the end of it, they all went to another level, and which they would eventually have to go. But I'm sorry, because I just want to make sure that got in, brother.
Yeah, no doubt.
Okay.
But yeah, I was gonna say too that I just wanted to see, like, you know, it was something that I was like peeping out, like based on the masonry, you know what I'm saying? And you know how, like, this country like came up through that basically, and it was just like from what I observed through, you know, like, you know, what we see and, you know, things we read about, it kind of seemed like, you know, the you know, some of the violence, like as far as the lynchings and the murderings, like were they like Masonic sacrifices, like to that deity?
They're always trying to line themselves with energy. They've been proven, I'm sure Lean has talked about this plenty of times, that a lot of those lynchings and sacrifices were Osirian rituals. They would cut off the penis, cut off the skin. Like, see, that's what we were beginning to talk about earlier. Like, a lot of these things are symbolic, like drinking out the skull, you know what I mean? These things are symbolic, but because they have nothing spiritual that they can actually work with to use as a tool for their transformation, they have to take it down to the physical to try to get the energy. And they can only, and if they're doing these energies to God, we God. Our skin is God. Melanin is God. So they're eating pine needles, eating black penises. Dr. Africa talked about, he had a book where they would show you the correct way to cook a black woman's ass. You know what I'm saying? Like, of course it is. They're not doing none of this for nothing. None of this for nothing. For instance, the angry guy with the pitchfork running around, he's the idiot. But the guy taking the picture and picking out the tree, he's the occultist, or he's the guy in the club. You get what I'm saying? Whatever club that may be. And you know, I mean, and it's still based upon, it's not really based upon no science. It's based upon hate, and they're just making hate scientific. Or what they think to be scientific. You get what I'm saying?
Right, right. I wanted to ask you too, like when you have an altar set up and, you know, you put up, you know, your deities or whatever, your relatives and that thing, do you and you want to put out something that's you want to put out something for them? Like something that they like, the food or whatever. Like you just set it out there for them, or
make a little plate. The easiest way to think of it as if they're still sitting right there. You get what I'm saying? So you know, make a plate, let them eat what you eat. You know what I'm saying? You know, chips and dip, and talk as if they are there. Talk as if anything you do in any ritual, any operation, any magical operation, anything that you're doing, talk as if, deal with it as if, you know what I'm saying? Not as if it's about to happen, as if it's happening. So instead of thinking of it as you're calling on your aunt who's on your altar, talk as if she's already there. You get what I'm saying? Deal with it as if she's already there. Because if you put a picture up, that's automatically a gateway. So if, you know what I mean? So think, feeding them is only energizing them. They eat off the essence of that food. You get what I'm saying? You know, things they like is only enticing them because they liked it as a human. So that's what keeps them interested in this. That's what I was pointing out again with the Orishas, because we're feeding them and doing everything to them. That's why they're here. They was trying to get out too, but based upon our ignorance, they got just as ignorant. You get what I'm saying? Just as ignorant, and they are actually locked in as us as well. So the idea is, you want to, instead of having to use your will and your force and your meditations to try to make something happen, you bypass all of that by seeing it as happening now. You get what I'm saying? Seeing it as happening now. So don't look at it like you have to contact your aunt. Look at it as you already made an altar or a gateway. Deal with it as she did. Talk as if she's doing it now, and you'll see results.
Okay, right. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, that's good, man. I appreciate that.
Yes, sir. No doubt.
All right. Peace.
Peace, brother.
Peace. All right, we got another caller. 04. Gola 704.
Oh, yes.
Peace.
Hey, peace. Just really listening in. This is a good show, Panic. I love the information. I want you to know I've been working with the fairies, leaving some...
That's what's up.
Yeah, leaving some oxtails.
Yeah.
Leaving some oxtails out, and I probably, you know, already sent you an email about that.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, the work got done like right away the next day, you know, what was put out there had, you know, come up. So tonight I'm going to send them some steak out, you know, and ask for some other shit.
Yes, yes, that's a good look. If people haven't heard, one of the rituals I gave out is this way, if you want to contact fairies, what you need to do is find a tree and start dealing with one tree, usually a tree in your backyard or front yard, but you got to feed that tree. And, you know, just whatever you like, you know, and whatever you wish it upon. So the fairies is nothing but the quantum world. That tree can become a gateway once you adopt the tree. You got to do shit, oddly enough, like hug a tree, too. You know, niggas, you know, you always hear that. You're a tree-hugging hippie, but that green tree connects with the heart chakra, and then you open a gateway to the fairy kingdom when you start doing that. You know what I'm saying? So you might want to pick a tree in your backyard if, you know, you're scared what your neighbors are going to think. You know what I'm saying? And fruit, you know, apple pie, cakes, all of that. We stay feeding our tree. Now, I didn't say this, but I'll say it now. If you want to contact dark fairies, you put out rotten food, and then the dark fairies will come. If you need to throw an ass kicking, you know, we need to stop kicking our own black asses with this. You need to throw an ass kicking to the powers that be, to the Ope, to Mr. Charlie.
Right.
Fuck Mr. Charlie up. You can fuck up Mr. Charlie or whatever. You know what I mean? You need to get something heavy done. And also know, these things aren't just to get shit done and ask for shit. One of the best things you could ask for is wisdom.
Okay.
So, wisdom. So, see, this is what should occur. If you put down oxtails and you got something done that quick, then you should be very eager to say, well, now I want to know something. If I can get you to, you know, get my flat tire fixed, then maybe you could tell me something I don't know. You get what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, this shit is about risk. When I contact spirits, I'm asking them, tell me something I don't know. Not just, oh, shit, good. Keep that rent popping. For the most part, what keeps the rent popping is what me and Brother Aleem were just talking about. When you somebody that you knew here, when you raise them up, because those people understand what it is to pay rent, to have a job, because they were just here. You get what I'm saying? Fairies weren't really here in the context where they had to go to a 9-to-5. You know what I mean? I mean, some black folk are fairy folk. Don't get that wrong. Those folks are the folks that, you know, you meet somebody and they just can't stop smiling and shit.
That's me.
They got fairy. That's why they came so easy with the oxtail, because you wanted them. You get what I'm saying? You wanted them. You just, if somebody say, I bet you can't stop smiling, and you start smiling, that's, you got fairy in your blood, like Sookie. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You straight up Sookie. You know what I'm saying? So you want to ask them for that wisdom. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
That's like a very important thing, a very important step that most people skip. You know, they're most surprised that they actually showed up, but actually they're going to show up. All that's going to show up. You just realizing it is what we're getting down to. Not you, but, you know, people realizing it is what we're getting down to. So, like, again, it's a balance. It's dark and light fairies. Put that rotten food out. That rotten meat, shit, motherfuckers will come. You know what I'm saying? I put out some old-ass chicken, raw, and the bones just kept showing up in the driveway. I said, niggas love that shit. You know what I mean? We keep something out there. You know what I mean? Keep something out there. So, yeah, that's good. I'm glad you did that. I'm glad it's working, and I'm glad you brought that up. But, yeah,
I just want to thank you for that information.
Yeah, that's kind of the biggest thing. I do remember you, too. I remember you emailing. I think we talked on the phone before when you did it, too, right?
No, this is the first time. First time.
Oh, okay. Then it must have been just an email. I remember you saying you put out them oxtail. Or did you type that in the chat room or something before?
No, just strictly email. I was going to cook them oxtails. I had bought them
right. One
of them Spanish stores, and then just,
right.
You know, I was listening
okay.
to you that night, and, you know, I was like,
right.
damn, okay. Let me go and get these over.
Okay, right, okay. Then it had to be email, but I do remember those oxtails. I was like,
yeah.
Shit. So, yeah, that's good. I'm glad. But, again, like I said, you want to, now that you know you can get them through that tree, you want to start asking for some wisdom. You know what I mean? So start telling them to start enlightening you with some shit. You know what I mean?
Okay.
You wake up with all sorts of good ideas.
Now, in terms of putting it out there, daytime, nighttime, doesn't really matter, does it?
Doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. Whenever the food is there, you know what I mean? There's also this, too, of what I'm saying. This is not to contact fairies. But when you clean out your refrigerator,
mm-hmm.
the old food, you can move it around your aura. Just move it around, hold it in your hand like a head
mm-hmm.
of lettuce. If it's not too good, really old food, move it around your aura and clean yourself and then put
mm-hmm.
it out in the bag. You don't necessarily have to put that by the tree because you're cleaning yourself. Just put that out by the road or somewhere out in nature. See, I used to do, this was a big time ritual in New York I used to do. Y'all may be able to do it wherever you're at, but you get a loaf of bread and clean your aura with that loaf of bread, then you feed it to the birds, and then they'll take your issue away. And you got to see whatever issue you have going into that loaf of bread. And, we used to just sit in the park to feed pigeons, and then when
mm-hmm.
they fly off with that issue. If you're in a place where you can feed pigeons, that's something you could do, or feed some ducks, you know what I mean? But
mm-hmm.
if you can't do that, you could just clean your aura with the food and just throw it in one of them forests on the side of the road. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
I can really see that, Brother Panic. I could definitely see how that translates. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. Peace.
Not a problem, sis. Peace.
All right, we got another caller, 601. Caller 601, area code 601, you're on the line. Caller 601, you're on the line. All right, we're going to go to the next one. 267. Caller 267, you're on the line.
How you doing?
Peace.
Yo, yo.
Peace. Yeah, so I just wanted to understand how, there's a lot of things going about activating your pineal gland.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just trying to, fast forward that, if that can be, you know what I mean? Your ancestors can help you with that as well? Or activate anything there or anything like that?
Because look at it this way. All the ancestors, the deities, anything we can name right now, are all a support team for what it is you're trying to do it, spiritually. Primarily, what you're trying to do is have your own realization. And as we pointed out the in this show, that this quest for the Holy Grail, which is this enlightenment, is your quest alone. You, at the end of the day, it's something you have to do. Now, another way to explain it is you who are going to have to do chakra work, kundalini work, and deal with your own pineal. You're going to have to raise the energy to your head, which represents that quest, for you to have your own aha moments. Now, deities, ancestors, honks, and the rest of that are support and can be used as help for your path and the realization, but at the end of the day, the quest is yours, just like for Horus, the fight is his. Just like for Hercules, the 12 labors are his. You get what I'm saying? You know, so all of that stuff is set up as a support team, but think about it on this level. If you are able to contact the ancestors, why wouldn't we just say, well, ancestors, tell me the meaning of life. Tell me why we're here. You don't never get that because they cannot spoil your path that way. You get what I'm saying? In fact, that's why there is no regular fluid conversation. Most of it is choppy and symbolic, like the dreams that you're there to decode. No one's just going to tell you this is the meaning of life because there's no – you're supposed to find your own meaning. So, yes, they help you do that, but there are a thousand things that help you deal with the pineal. Most of those are through meditation, little things. If you stick the tongue at the roof of your mouth and hum, you start to vibrate the pineal. Like I said, I've offered a shortcut, which is the herb pack. That's what that does. It opens up the pineal. It doesn't give you an experience, though you get an experience, but it's not a drug experience. It's not a peyote experience. It is actually medicine for your pineal. But I've given out thousands of things you could do for absolutely scot-free. Aline has given out meditation. All of those things are things for you to, whenever you close your eyes, what you're doing, the idea is that you are looking within. And to look within, all those realizations and all those ideas, those aha moments, those things that make you go, well, maybe I should try this, or maybe I should stop doing that, or maybe I should finish reading that. Those are your, that is your pineal talking to you, telling you how to become that watcher, how to become that netaru, where you have constant pineal activity. In fact, you balance out your life with that eye constantly open. See, my life is balanced because the pineal is constantly open. So everything I look at with my regular human eyes are still superseded by my third eye now. So now I say, you know something? We shouldn't go into the store today. Know something? Let's stay home today. Know something? Let's not do that. Know something? We need to do that because it doesn't – see, prior to that, what I had to do is, you know, last night I had a dream. We shouldn't do that. Last night I had this overwhelming feeling and this happened. We shouldn't do it. I don't even have to tell those stories no more. No, we shouldn't do it because you do so much work. You do so much experiments. You do so much what comes to your own mind as what you should be doing for your pineal to have so much attention that is now been like it's been doing push-ups and been working out, and it becomes strong. It is just like someone who has been in a coma and has atrophied. So the meditations, these tricks, I've given out. Let me say this. Email me, panicpack@hotmail.com, and I will also mail you all the shows I've done with all their topics for absolutely scot-free. I've given out so many techniques on the pioneer. You get Tiger's Balm. You put Tiger's Balm on your third eye, get into that meditation. That alone will start pineal activity. You get what I'm saying? You can move it to your temples. You get what I'm saying? There's so many things that you could do.
What was that heat again?
I'm sorry. Say that one more time, brother.
You talking about Tiger's Balm?
No. It sounds like your phone is breaking up. Oh, the email? panicpack@hotmail.com, panicpack@hotmail.com. Just email me, say you need the show list, and I'll send you the list. And again, if you want a product list, I'll send you all the products I have to open up the pineal, clean the aura, all that. This is old hat. This is not like a new thing that's happening. This is old hat. So, but if you never heard of this, I also want you to point out that you never heard of this because I want to be able to give you back information on what it is I sell. But I definitely would like you to get a free show list, and then you could. And I deal with so many subjects, so many transmissions of what you could do for your pineal, how to practically apply the ancestors and deities so they can aid you in that. Because at the end of the day, deities are nothing but definitions of energies, and these energies are supposed to work with you to bring this thing up. So this is the deity is the methodology for calling on an energy to help you have a realization where you have. There's levels of kundalini energy. The physical level always happens. That's what makes you a black person. That's what makes you not mountain climb and skydive, because you have a constant connection or pathway to a certain level of physical kundalini, which is life force energy. So you're not looking out of yourself to jump off something, bungee jump every day for that life force. That's why Mr. Charlie, that's my new shit for the week, Mr. Charlie. That's why Mr. Charlie always has to jump off of something, climb something, just do dumb shit. What is the purpose of fucking a skateboard riding down a banister? You know what I'm saying? That shit is killing you two because they don't have that melanin, that kundalini energy. So now the physical level, when you go to sleep, they call it your beauty sleep. The kundalini rises, hit the pineal, a certain amount of melanin comes out, but it gets absorbed in the nervous system. That's where you get that statement of black don't crack, because that melanin is going back into the skin, into the wrinkles and all of that. So, but the idea is once you start to spiritualize it, what starts to happen is you start to retain some of that melanin in that holy grail. Remember, the head is that holy grail, the fire castle or the cup. So the melanin starts to stay in there. In the William Henry book, what he says, because he cannot say the word melanin, he says, well, it changes into pinealine. And then, you know, when it stays in the brain, that's when it starts to ferment, like water into wine, and then the DMT shit starts to kick in. Now, that's true, but what it is most of the melanin that runs once you reach that, when the kundalini starts hitting, I know how to retain it in the brain for that. It becomes gasoline for a spiritual transmission instead of being reabsorbed into me having a sexy look, if you will. So there's this meditation. You want to get into meditations, get you a how-to of meditation, because it's trying to teach you how to focus in and stay in your inner world. And that's where you start. The journey for the grail, it starts in your inner world. It doesn't, there's nothing outside of you that you're going to find that's going to help you. Most people think that the ancestors and the deities are outside of you anyway. They talk to you from within. We just call it, something told me I shouldn't have did that, or something told me I should have did that when you fuck up. The idea is before you fuck up to say something told you, that something told you becomes a detailed conversation or a detailed guidance system that you can rely on for your path. You get what I'm saying? So,
yes,
so again, get to the back show.
I got some Reiki, I went to a Reiki session December 31st, right before the New Year's, or this New Year's, rather. And the Reiki said that every part of my body was connected to an ancestor.
Mm-hmm.
And, I'm really kind of having a hard time, you know what I mean?
I'm going to tell you, that's really not profound. In a way where you should be busting your mind over. Every part of your body has a spiritual connect. There's more than seven chakras. So there's, like, they say, like 209 chakras, depending, and even different things. When we use acupressure and acupuncture, they're hitting chakras. Each chakra is situated in a spiritual world, as it comes through. It's a gateway. So that would situate your body that would say the ancestors are all over your body, or the spirits are all over your body, just based upon that. Or you can look at it this way, quite simple. In Egypt, there's something called the Temple of Luxor, which is the Temple of Man. You start at the feet, and you get initiated and go all the way through the head. And each part tells a spiritual story on each of the walls, which means that is connected to spirits or the ancestors or the deity. So your body is a divine temple. Even the Christians will tell you your body is a temple. So if it's a temple, what is it supposed to house? Well, your soul, the ancestors. See, your soul is a quantum entity, which means it is a connected to all things. And we should know this because we subconsciously call ourselves soul brothers. You get what I'm saying? We call ourselves brothers based upon the soul and based upon the quantum reality, which is connected to all things. So on a spiritual level, your body is connected to all things. The ancestors live within you. They live within your DNA. You get what I'm saying? So I think what he did was try to present that to you with no explanation to make it a little bit more profound. Now, actually, it is profound, but it could be – but he didn't explain it to you in detail where he simplified something with so that is profound. You follow
right.
What I'm saying?
Yeah, it's mystical, but it's not metaphysical.
Right. It's mystical, but on a certain level is an obvious thing. You know what I mean? Your DNA is your ancestors' DNA. You have your DNA of your mother and your father and their mother and their father and blah, 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 blah. So that's your whole body. How could the ancestors not be in you if you're a DNA being? You get what I'm saying? There's a spiritual level to DNA as well, and you're connected to that that goes beyond the physical, and you're connected to certain deities and certain individuals. Where you're like, damn, you. I'm sure you have friends, everyone does, in their life, where you know that's your motherfucking brother. And I'm sure you have physical brothers when you go, I don't know who the fuck that motherfucker is. You know what I'm saying? Because that's a more spiritual connection and a spiritual thing. So we are all one thing. You can't get away from it. You get what I'm saying? It is what it is. Like, if he would have told you that, you would have just walked out and said, okay. You know what I'm saying? But he's telling you some shit that you need to walk with. Like, see, my cousin was telling me one day, he was with my grandfather, right on my grandfather's deathbed. My grandfather was a straight, dark magician nigga, all them early societies, he was in that shit, all that OTO shit. So this nigga, and my cousin knew that, he's younger, so my cousin's like, yo, this nigga said to me, that which knows and knows no bounds from the heart. Some old bullshit like that. And he said, then the nigga died a couple of days later. I said, I would have woke his fucking ass. What the fuck does that mean? You know what I'm saying? They're going to have me, this nigga, 5 years later, he's still trying to figure that bullshit out. You get what I'm saying? So it's like niggas will tell you some shit. You be trying to figure that shit. Ask that motherfucker, what the fuck does that mean? You know what I'm saying? Most of us, like, don't want to seem like it's profound. And we don't scout. This motherfucker say some old weird shit. All right, nigga, you need to re-explain that shit. You know what I'm saying? And you can just take what Malcolm X said. He said a true teacher could take something that's very profound and explain it to you like you in the third grade. That's the mark of a true teacher. That's the mark of what we call breaking something down. You get what I'm saying? If we break something down, you need to take something that's high and make it easy, you know what I'm saying, for folk. You know, that's the idea. So when if somebody says some shit like that to you, you need to sit there and say, can you tell me that another fucking way, sir? Especially if you're paying for a goddamn Reiki session. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
You paying for that session. That nigga need to come up with some book. He need to come up with some goddamn book. You know, some goddamn. He need to come harder than that. The ancestors live within your body. Where the fuck at, nigga? Like, you know what I'm saying? Can I get rent? You know, something. You know.
You know, yeah, it's real simple. Yeah, your ancestors are nothing more than your jeans, and you wear them.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Every
and they ain't talking about your pants either. All right, so
right.
We'll go to
right.
The next.
Right. There you go.
All right. We had a question in the chat room about Gervalo Melchizedek. You want to talk about the Flower of Life? Anything on that?
You mean the thousand petal lotus type thing?
It's
just another symbol of it's the Kundalini is nothing but the seed at the base of your spine. It grows, and it's just another way of telling you the goal is the flowering happens at that point in the head. It's just another thing that points in the head. Now, is because we're putting it all together, and because we're advanced people, that no longer sounds profound. But at the time when this was written, you were born into that society, so it wasn't like you can cross-reference all of these things. You get what I'm saying? So it would take a while to see that lotus was there, and you know, that goddess in the lotus, and all of these things. But it's a concept more than something that's going to happen. The concept is that the fruit from that tree, the spine, the pillar of Osiris is also the tree of life. It's the same spinal kundalini. At the end of the day, there's probably five things you should be doing. The most profound thing is raising kundalini, because what you're doing is connecting. In the Shiva Parvati story, the Shiva Shakti story, Shakti represents that unlimited power or energy. Shiva is sleeping. which represents the pioneer. Shakti meets Shiva, and he's awakened. So,
right.
Or he's blossomed. Now, or in the
Set,
regular...
Or Set meets Osar and resurrects him.
Right.
Yeah.
And resurrects him. Right. She gets
right.
on top of him, resurrects him, and Horus represents that flower or that fruit of that coming
right.
together. It's the same concept. Even in the marriage that we have today, it's the same Shakti ritual, Shakti Shiva ritual. The man
right.
waits at the altar, and the woman walks up the aisle and meets him. And
right.
then his life's supposed to begin because of his wife has approached. Here comes the bride. So it's the same thing. Now, because of the Shakti or Kundalini energy, not only is Shakti later becomes the goddess Kundalini, but they would even say for whatever consort, Vishnu and Lakshmi, Lakshmi would be Vishnu Shakti, meaning the activating force. Now, the head also represents, again, the sleeping father, the Osiris. You get what I'm saying? So Isis coming together, activating Osiris, and so on. It's all the same story, just rehashed, retold. But remember, it's easy for us to retell them because we're able to look at all of these stories and put them under one umbrella. If you were in a society where they only had three of these tellings, if you just was like just dealing with Kemetic science or you just was dealing with Hindu science, it would be maybe harder to see this. And really what I noticed the hardest thing about seeing these things are actually the mindset that comes along, because the information can be absorbed by anybody. Any fool could read a book and any fool could repeat it. But the mentality that we have usually that's where it gets elusive. Like, for instance, what we were just talking about when I was saying, no, if a motherfucker says something weird, should ask that nigga Johnny on the spot. That more deals with the mentality, because I'm sure you're confident enough to know if that nigga said, well, the ancestors in your DNA, you'd have been done right there. Oh, I know that, and walked away. But so it's the mentality, as if someone came with this wise word and they know something that they can only tell you in certain kind of ways. You know, that's just too much. You get what I'm saying? It is. You want to keep this in the mentality of who and what it is that you truly are, because that's once you see. Most people think you become conscious, and once you become conscious, you're supposed to, your social behavior is supposed to change. What it is you do is supposed to change. So with this external change that's happened, you no longer could analyze as you've been trained to analyze your entire life being yourself. So if I was a regular nigga and we was at a motherfucking hip-hop concert and I said the ancestors are all over your body, and we were sitting around listening to fucking DMX, 50 Cent, you would say, what the fuck did you just say? But since somebody's doing Reiki and they say the shit, you get to walk away going, what the fuck does that mean? Because because we thinking consciousness is something other than how you analyze. One of the first things I realized, this learning this shit ain't supposed to be, I'm not supposed to be becoming something new. What's supposed to be happening here is I'm supposed to figure out why I was doing the shit I've been doing my entire life. Right, and there's a phrase for that called know thyself, not know how to become a nigga who says Hotep, a Lafia, and peace be unto you. It's know thyself. So all the, even the flawed shit that I did, that's the first thing I started to embrace. Instead of saying, once I become conscious, all that dumb shit, I'm going to stop smoking weed and all the rest of that shit. Nah. I said, I'm going to embrace why I do this dumb shit and start to love it. I'm going to know myself. And based upon that, nothing has changed. So if a nigga say some dumb shit to me, I don't get to say, oh, my brother, peace be unto you, I must meditate on that and think some fuck. I'm like, what the fuck you talking about? So it's the mentality that is actually the hardest part about consciousness, not even the information. It's the fucking mentality. So once we get our mentality, if we can maintain our straight mentality as we did, that's equivalent to staying sane. For years, you would hear things like, well, You study this occult information and go insane. You would fuck with them spirits and go insane, and you would go insane. And then I said, oh, I know what the insanity is. You would study this shit, and then you become some nigga going, oh, Hotep, goddess, peace be unto you. Them niggas actually went insane, because you don't do that in real fucking life. You go to your fucking job. You don't say to your boss, oh, Hotep, I'll get that work done. You get what I'm saying? Which means you're performing. You know what I'm saying? Hotep, let me finish sweeping out the fucking the Wendy's. Let me finish sweeping Alafia. You know what I'm saying? Niggas are like, wait a minute, what the fuck is you talking about? So that means you're performing. You get what I'm saying? So that performance and that dress and that all of that balance, that is the insanity. That is the insanity of dealing with this shit. You get what I'm saying? If you are able to maintain who you were while you deal with this shit, you are sane. Again, I pointed out, the same brother who called said this nigga said that shit to him while he was doing Reiki. Again, if we was at a DMX concert and he said that shit, I guarantee that brother said, what the fuck are you talking about? So that means he sees it as two different experiences. He needs to be himself. Like, look, you know what I'm saying? You eat spaghetti. You don't need to get around a bunch of vegans going, look, you know what I'm saying? That spaghetti is, I only eat gluten-free, five-day-old, organic, non-hydrogenated spaghetti. Like, you don't do that. You lying. So the insanity is actually the social being that you become just to fit in. You know what I'm saying? Now, you know, instead of just saying you look good to get some ass, it becomes you are the goddess, the first, the queen. There is none before you. There is none after you. Your breasts are the cradle of life and civilization. Can I get some pussy? You know what I'm saying? It's like, come on, stop fronting. You know what I'm saying? Can I get some pussy now, my queen? It's like, because, see, I get a lot of the questions, and the sisters hit me back. I got with this nigga. You know what I'm saying? This nigga just done fell in love with some Hotep me. You know what I'm saying? Your locks are from divine, you know, trees that sprout forth fruit that bring forth the mother nature and earth itself. You know the drawers is coming down after. You know the drawers is coming down after that. Then she's like, this nigga done stole my credit. Uh-huh.
So you know that's some good poetry shit.
Yeah, it always works. You know what I'm saying? I'll run that shit if I can pull it off. The gumballs of life I would like to chew on before I get through on you on. And my song goes as far as this. You will never miss, miss, because the breasts, I love to caress. And let me tell you what's next. I will take your feet, give them in honey. This ain't about money, but I will shower you with riches and quit all my other bitches. And, oh, this nigga right here. This nigga is divine, telling I want to bring my Oblex to your house and all this shit. And then I get this email. That nigga stole my credit card. He beat my kids. He ate all my cereal. I ain't got no gas money. You know what I'm saying? I need grocery money. Oh, a regular nigga, because he figured out a dialogue to fuck with your ego. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So it all amounts to insanity. So I'm thinking, you know, when you first, there's a spirit that's going to come when you deal with this occult and just fuck you up. You're going to be outside shitting in a newspaper. You get what I'm saying? Talking to a fire hydrant.
Ooh.
And I'm sitting there like, and I'm like, no, it ain't that. It's this kind of shit I'm seeing on goddamn Facebook right now. You know, it's this shit that I'm seeing on Facebook right now that says that's the insanity we're dealing with, where you actually lose yourself in this social behavior where you don't even exist. So if this is about knowing yourself, you're two steps behind because you're not even knowing yourself. You're just knowing the right thing to say at the right time, either now for pussy or either now for just to seem divine. Oh, my wonderful king that conquers the world and rides the planets and conquers the earth on elephants of Hannibal. Nigga feeling real souped up after that shit. You know what I'm saying? Nigga feeling real good. And it's like, that's all it really does is make you feel real good. You know what I'm saying? And so that's the insanity. You know what I'm saying? That's the insanity. And I can't stress that enough. The idea here is Can you retain who you are? There, remember there was a big thing, Aline, with I can no longer hang with dead people. Remember that? Oh,
right,
now
right.
that I'm conscious, I can't hang with dead people. Then I said, that's not it. That's a phase, or should be a phase, where you're learning something new. But now every single dead motherfucker that I used to hang with, I can still hang with them. You get what I'm saying? Because
right.
really, it was a whole path of not me changing, just understanding who I am. You get what
that's
I'm saying?
Right.
And by me understanding who I am, I understand who they are. So if
yep.
I was new when I was a friend before, the same level of friendship it is. I don't sit around, so they go, yeah, Jesus, it sure is good. I just sit around and go, yes, he is. Because I don't
yep.
give a fuck to inform them. You know what I'm saying? I know
right.
the work that's done. We got all of this. So it's
right.
it's not really an exciting, it's not even exciting. I can laugh with my friends at the movies for the sake of laughing with my friends at the movies and with no other agenda. See, it's an agenda to be able to try to educate these dead, dumb. That's a, you don't need that. Educate your deaf, dumb, and blind ass first. You know what
that's
I'm saying?
Right.
So it was a phase. I couldn't fuck with my friends for a while. I'm conscious now. Then that shit wore out quickly. The boss hung around conscious motherfuckers.
Ain't
that God
true.
Damn. At least my friends I had fun with. You know what I'm saying? You know what
yeah.
I mean? Nigga wasn't scared to eat some butter at the movie
yeah,
theater or some
least,
popcorn.
At least them niggas loyal.
Right, at least them niggas is loyal, you know what I'm saying? These motherfuckers here, boy, shit. There was this built-in thing where if somebody says the word melanin, they automatically became your number one friend. You know what
sure.
I'm saying? You know, Pineal Gland, oh, this is brother Izod, you know what I'm saying? Pineal Gland, oh, brother Izod, he's one of us. And then these motherfuckers, and then there's always some slimy shit down the road. Always, and then I started thinking, I said, okay, most or a few conscious people would say, you know, I couldn't get along with humans, that's why I'm here. Then I started to realize, maybe you just are not an agreeable motherfucker before this information. You only became conscious because conscious people like to say, I'm an outcast, I'm a black sheep. Maybe nobody liked your ass in the beginning. Because if you see, you know what I'm saying, maybe nobody fucking liked you anyway. You only became conscious because it became the national anthem to say, I don't get along with humans. I don't get along with the world. I get along with all motherfuckers. I understand the science of humanity versus your God mind and all of that, but that's not what people are on. You can't get to call these people dead and then get mad that they are dead. You know what I'm saying? In the context we call them that. But still, they are, you know, these are, I have friends for 20, 30 years. You just because you said the word Kundalini, that don't mean we buddies. You know what I'm saying? And
right.
oh, but brother, you know, that's, you know, people all the time, and I'm sure you get it too, they'll say something that's just a little overstepping the bounds, and you get to go, look, motherfucker, brother, we as a people and as Kundalini beings and light workers, I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? I don't know you. I don't never call you that. And your own mother probably don't like you with a mouth like that. You know what I'm saying? You need to be honest. You know, be real. If you're dealing with this whole thing is to become the other, under, to deal with the nature of yourself, not to hide it. You get what I'm saying? Hide it in a goddamn kente cloth. Hide it in a goddamn ankh. You get what I'm saying? Before you even open your mouth and say what book and science that you know, by your behavior, you show that the inner workings are not really happening. You get what I'm saying? The inner
right.
workings are not really happening. You reveal yourself. When you got that inner thing, it pulls you in a place of peace and calm. We're not talking about if you bebopping and scatting on Facebook. I talk the most shit, put up the most pictures on Facebook. But guess what? It's Facebook. You get what I'm saying? When we turn Facebook off, the only people who need to take me seriously is myself.
All right.
I don't put on social fronts. You get what I'm saying? If I don't like you, I don't care how many locks you got. I'm going to say, look, man, get the fuck away from me. You know what I'm saying? You creeping me out. You know what I'm saying? Early on, I didn't do that. You know what I'm saying? Okay, brother. And you pay for that. You get what I'm saying? You pay not in a big way. You know, nobody stole a pinky toe, but it's like, wait a minute. If I just met this dude at a rap show, he wouldn't have gotten that far next to me because you just don't know him. This Kundalini word talk, you know what I'm saying, seems to put people close. That's because I said, oh, okay, you're talking about a great deal of social misfits. Not everyone. Patty said the whole conscious community is social misfits. No. No. But a portion are social misfits, and there's no denying that. Whatever event you go through, there's always one that's going to say some shit. That's like, where did you come from? So I started to realize the more time I just dealt, especially on Facebook and all that, started to realize that I said, okay, these people really couldn't get along, but conscious social behavior dictates if you can't get along, we'd love you to come on in with us. Get you an ankh, get a kente kit, just add water, and you're in. Words you need to know. Chaos, Illuminati, pineal, melanin, chakra, yin, yang, polarity, and last but not least, Mercury is in retrograde. whenever something fucks up for you, just say, Mercury is in retrograde. And then you will always get off the hook. You're like, yo, you called my mother a bitch. I'm sorry. Mercury was in retrograde. Mercury is in retrograde. Now, I joke on that. Mercury is in retrograde when it is what it is. But what I'm talking about is people using this as an excuse. It's always something. You just can't be yourself. You're saying things. I was falling into that shit, saying words like your paradigm. And I'm like, I looked at myself on tape. I said, I'm stopping right now. I'm stopping this shit. I'm stopping this shit. I looked at myself and said the word paradigm once. I said, I'm stopping. Enough. Let me go start buying books. Enough. I said, who the fuck am I? So I know from experience. I was falling into that bullshit, too. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yes, my. I couldn't go as far as, like, bow and cross my arms and all that kind of shit. Fist to the chest, which I was doing anyway. But I was saying words that was socially acceptable. And then, so I know for a fact. I'm not talking just because I'm judging. I know if I said, I looked. See, but the difference between me and a lot of other folk is I was on tape early, and a lot of people ain't seeing themselves. You get what I'm saying? What they're trying to do is see themselves in other people in the social group. So they're seeing if they fit in. So they say hotel, I say hotel. They say paradise, I say paradise. I was looking at myself and judging myself for myself going, who the fuck is this guy? I remember being on a tape praising another tape that I didn't see. Oh, this will be legendary, and I knew when this was going to drop, it was going to do this, and this, that, the other, and the other thing. And I'm sitting there going, wait a minute, I didn't even see this shit yet. You know what I'm saying? This shit may have failed. And I'm like, no, I got to stop. And we was doing, it was a tape where it was a nut-hugging fest. Rudra was watching it with me. Rudra said these words and it echoed with me. He said, whatever I become, I don't want to become that. And everybody's like, yeah, because when you dropped it on that, when you dropped it on this, and that the way you dropped it on this, and the way you dropped it on that, and the way you dropped it on this, I looked at it and said, that's a number of the ego fest. I, in my heart, know I only read a few books at this point. There's nothing I dropped. You know what I'm saying? I just dropped some attitude. So that's the shit that I was like, no, I'm going to fucking study. I want to study. I do not want to become some guy who's walking around, you know what I'm saying, smelling like nutmeg, you know, holding beads for no reason. You know what I mean? For no reason. So I know that well. I know that early on. So when I see it, I'm going hard on this, but I think it's one of the most important things. You see people building up the outside for the lack of inner work. When you do that inner work, you only realize why you used to pee the bed when you was three. You only realize, you know what I'm saying, why you only washed your ass in a counterclockwise way, why you are scared of trains. All the stuff that was in your life, then it makes the thing come, that one statement come into to true being. Know thyself, not know thy way you're supposed to act. You know what I'm saying? Now I feel for every single thing I've done, every fear I had, every single thing, I know why. I know there's an origin. I know there's a spirit. I know there's even things in past lives now come. I think that's what know thyself means. If I was sitting around putting fronts, cause you know, and people say, well, brother, you kind of coarse, you kind of crass. You know, what do you think? I'm stupid. If I wanted to get more people, just to be, you know, to be that guy for some capital. Oh, that's easy. Like I'm like people are like, well, you coarse and you could have did that if you would have did that. I'm like, No, what do you think? I don't know how to say, oh, blessed beloved. And call everybody
you
beloved.
You
don't think.
You know what I'm saying? They tell me the same shit. I said, oh, well, I mean, I guess what, you want me to do a Joel Osteen? Well, my father once told me. You know what I'm saying? I mean, what the fuck you want me to do?
Right. It's like, I'm sitting there like, wait a minute, you think I'm scratching my head? Oh, you mean if I talk nice, more people will cheerlead me? Oh, I couldn't figure that out. I said, but I'm going to do something, give them a surf. I'm going to do something and give them a little bit more benefit of the doubt. I'm going to be real with them. You get what I'm saying? I'm going to be 100% real with them. I don't call you beloved because you're not my fucking beloved. I've never said that word. So I'm not going to say it now just to make you. I've never said hotep. I'm not going to say it now to make you feel like I'm in with you, that I'm communicating with you on a certain level. And that is doing the service. I'm giving it to you raw and real. And it seems to be working because when I went to that lecture, there was a whole bunch of old ladies giving me hugs. I was embarrassed, you know what I'm saying, with all the cursing I do. You going to say something, but I'm sorry to cut you off.
Oh, no, you ain't cutting me off. I just said I do once in a while say hold tap.
I mean, but it is – no. I mean, I'm not being – like, if it's something that's in you, I don't want to – see, I don't want to make it seem like saying the word hold tap automatically makes you fucked up. But that's why I pointed out. I've never said it. That's why I pointed out the word paradigm. I've never said – that's not a bad word, and it's not something nobody's not supposed to say. But I never said it. So you get what I'm saying? So for me to say it is me doing something wrong against me. And if people say it, I'm not trying to demonize that word or put no particular person under no spotlight. What I'm talking about is being true to yourself. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
If the word hotep resonates with you, then say it as the day is long. But we know a great deal is just saying it to fit in. That's why I brought up the story, like, all them hoteps and queens and I believe in the sister, your eyes are the eyes of the universe and all of that shit. And then they say it was just a regular old nigga. Nigga had a gun around my house. And these are true life stories. Nigga came and pissed on my rug, panicked. I said, yeah, but what was he telling you before? Oh, your fingers are the fingers that open the locks of all keys and the water of noon and all this kind of shit. Yup. I said, because they figured out, once you can figure out a dialogue or some game, they got your ass. Because if you're used to hearing these words as buzzwords, instead of using what you use from what's from your heart, you get what I'm saying? When you deal with, if you say, I say hotep, good. That if it's from your heart, then you're going to know who's giving you a sincere hotep. If you say hotep from your heart, and I'm forced to say hotep, then you should be able to hear, this nigga ain't really hotepping me correctly.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's not real. So, you know, so I'm not trying to believe you. Let me be clear. I'm not trying to demonize the word of anybody who says it. Like, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, I'm speaking in my context. I've never said that word. I've never said and even more than hotep, that's why I try to use the word paradigm. You know what I'm saying? Where it ain't really, because I know hotep is our greeting. So I don't want to say anybody who greets. Oh, I'm not saying people don't greet me with hotep. Keep it real. This is the primary message. Keep it real.
That's what you do.
I'm not even going to look at it like that or judge you like that. I was basing it upon if you know your heart.
No. Nobody was taking it personal. You know what I'm saying?
No. I know you wasn't. But you know how we have to explain things down to the letter. I'm not really saying that you, but just to put it all on the line so nobody's getting confused because I know you know better, but you know, just so everybody understands.
Questions, we're gonna go to area code 317. Area code 317, you on the line? Area code 317, are you on the line? Area code 317.
Yes, I'm on the line.
Oh, okay. Peace.
Oh, you can hear me. Okay.
Yeah, we can.
Great. Hi, everyone. I was thinking about with the few who has basically messed up and got pirated, the government or whatever, by the extra terrorists, I guess you'd say, with what they're doing right now and trying to shut down, like, hijack the, you know, free information, even the weak ones like Wikipedia and all that, internet and all of this. I was trying to find out what type of ritual would you suggest to do as to right now they're trying to caused some type of pandemonium, I guess you'd say, with
you mean,
disease and...
You mean,
well,
you mean like a ritual to do it, to accomplish exactly what, like, to keep the internet open?
No, not at all. I'm just laying down what actually is going on, like right at this moment with what their plans are, with the internet, with the diseases, and with the artists that they're basically holding hostage, you know, with their plans of, you know, like they did with Michael Jackson, what they did with, like, Tupac, you know, things like that. What right now, we're in this transitional period, and what type of ritual would you suggest for people who can't go to Atlanta, Norway, and Australia, you know, to go underground?
Let's first identify they. Who's they?
Well, not the people, the extraterrestrials or the extraterrorists that are holding up the Illuminati, basically. They're holding them
down.
I'll do one better.
Well, this is what I tell you to sum all of that up.
Okay.
I've been talking to spirits since about 2007 on an advanced level, but maybe 2005 been making contact. So for 2 years making contact ancestors, and since 2007 to now, and I mean I could talk to anybody, anything in the universe. Not one thing has ever mentioned the Illuminati. Not one thing has ever mentioned chemtrails, they, vaccines, none of that. So if I don't see it in the spirit world, which is the real world, I pay very little heed to that. Everything I also see in the spirit world said everything that we are doing as conscious people is moving that ball, is that ball is still rolling. So my suggestion to any of those things is stop worrying about who they are, whatever name that was told on YouTube, and deal with all the above that you heard tonight. Get into yourself. Get into your power. Following
okay.
that?
And
so in other words, there's always a they, there's always a bad guy, and there always will be a bad guy. But at the end
not
of the day.
I'm not thinking about the bad guy. I'm thinking about not bad guys. I'm not worried about that. But I'm talking about
well,
the extraterrestrials.
Well, are they good guys, the extraterrestrials?
No. I mean, relative. It depends on what side of the coin you're on, you know.
I'm on the side of the coin that says do your own work, get into yourself, study your own shit, and there's no such thing as they, but you make it. So that's the side I'm on. So that's the only thing I really can speak on.
Okay, so what would you say to, as far as, like, working on yourself, okay, what would you say?
What I would say is what I've been saying for all of this show in the last 3 years on the radio, which, you can get that show list. So there's plenty of every show I did, and there's at least over 25 to 30 of them that I can give you for absolutely free, including shows on Tupac and Michael Jackson, where I lay out in every show of things you can do to enhance your powers. So just email me at panicpack@hotmail.com, get the free show list, and that question that you're asking, all of that stuff, in detail, and there's two shows, 3 hours each, of nothing but books you can get. I've also done a little synopsis of each book.
Okay.
Alrighty.
All right. Okay, thank you so much.
All right. The caller coming in at 540-540, area code 540, you're on the line.
This y'all's boy, no
yes.
thing.
Yes, please,
peace.
What up?
What up with you? Hey, yo, I was, I was doing some push-ups. But I was on YouTube, and I seen a video that you had left of called The Psych, The Shadow, The Ego, and The Self.
I
listened to the show, but I want you to just give me a quick breakdown of the shadow and pretty much just the shadow and the ego. Just give me a little quick.
All right. You got to listen to that show to really get it. The ego.
I did listen to it, but I just want to, you know what I'm saying, just hear it one more
you
time.
You want a little bit of elaboration on it. Let me find that title so I could go through each one. Hold on. Which is right here. The psyche, the shadow self, and the ego. The shadow self, this is based upon a model of Carl Jung. And I think I had the picture up at the time. And the shadow self is, they talk about the true self, subconscious mind. This also is represented in Osiris as actually that sleeping part, that Holy Grail. In the shadow self, it tells you characteristics of your shadow self, the anima. The anima is basically your urges, your urge to eat, cry, shit without you doing nothing, your automated features. Your anima also changes, but this changes upon the first god, your mother. So your mother, and basically if she nurtures you too much or nurtures you less, this is all dealing with the shadow part of yourself, this creates your characteristics and, of course, how you grow that woman. You see your mom get beat, you're going to be a woman beater, perhaps. See your moms get loved, you're going to be a woman lover, perhaps. So this is telling you on Earth how these things impact you. Now, on top of that, there's a line in the middle where you get into the ego. The ego, I explained in detail how in ancient civilizations they picked out your wife, they picked out your job, the caste system, y'all wore all the same clothes, all the boys went through one rite, all the girls went through one, all the huts were the same. So what this did, it wasn't just because they were, not only because they were in unison in the culture, they understood the concept of the human ego. The human ego really is more choice. People say now, I explained the detail, that's that nigga's ego. Panic got an ego, Lean got an ego, because he was talking this and that. That level, the ego, is not the occult level, because everyone needs an ego, else we'll all walk outside naked. Why did you pick those shoes? Why did you pick that hat? The ego actually protects you here in this world. It is your personality or your persona. So you need that. That has nothing to do with nothing. And though someone may have a big ego in that context, in the occult level, that doesn't matter. What matters is, are you living in your true path? You get what I'm saying? So the ego needs to be stifled when you're dealing with the science. See, I could be the biggest. Like, yeah, I'm panicking. It's like panic got an ego. But after I get off the radio, if I'm sitting down and the information, if I'm able to separate what I learned for the information and let it penetrate the shadow self without saying I'm panicked, so I should know this, that's a different story. Now, that may be a bad example, but that's the example. Because most of you know, he got an ego because he's talking about that. So I go into the detail in lecture form of how that really doesn't matter. You get what I'm saying? And what else can I talk about there? So I mean, like I said, nobody's really going to get the gist. And unless, you know, it's up on YouTube. Look for Brother Panic, the psyche, shadow self, and the ego. My YouTube is Occult Lectures at YouTube. You can find me easy. And I'm also on Facebook under Panic Demonium. If you're going to send me a friend request, also send me a note letting me know it's me, because, you know, everybody just friends everybody. I just want to know you know the work, so I'm available there. That's all you got to do is say you just know me and you're in. Now, so you can find that to get the detailed breakdown. I also pointed out, and I believe I pointed out there, but I point out here, a lot of what I do, if I put together a lecture, I don't remember it later, because my first agenda is not to memorize this to be able to tell people, so I'll forget all about it. It was what it was for the time. My first concern is studying for myself. You get what I'm saying? My second concern is sharing what I've learned. So I don't memorize. Or, in other words, half the shit from that, I don't even remember what I said. But at the time, it was, you know, it was what it was for I said. I don't like to have this constant speech to walk around, well, brother, be able to run it down. But, you know, so for the better part of me, if I do a subject in a lecture, is to listen to that lecture. It's not going to get any more deeper than that unless we're putting it in another context. All right?
Okay, yeah. I listened to it. I just want to see if, like, you could just elaborate a little bit more, but I understand where you're coming from, though.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was pretty thorough, you know what I mean? the way what I do notice is people will say the way I talk, they have to listen to it a couple of times to really get into it. And listen, that's not because I'm so cool as Swift. Sometimes I listen to Aleem and Bobby's tape. I used to listen to them 3 or 4 times in a row. Just, and each time I would hear something new. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I would always hear
something
new. You know what I mean? There's sections, if you don't have any of Aleem's lectures when he was doing them in that goddamn bookstore, you need to get some of that series. Y'all need to get some of that. Those lectures are like, I had them in a series, and when I get in the mood, I can watch that whole series back to back. Quite informative, and each time I hear it, I hear something new. So I know, because I talk real fast, because sometimes people will send me links of me, and I'm listening to 3 minutes and not knowing it's me. You know what I'm saying? Like, what the fuck is this? You know what I mean? I said, oh, that shit is me saying this. And then I listen. I'm like, no, that, I should have said that better. I'm talking so fast. You get what I'm saying? So so it is thorough. I know that's one of the ones I like. It is very thorough, but you're going to have to hear that a couple of times to really get, to really say, oh, okay. You know what I mean? But it's what it is, to make it a short elaboration, what it is, it's based upon the model of Carl Jung. It was Carl Jung and Sigmund Freud. Carl Jung kept spiritual ideas in his work, and Sigmund Freud just went the way of the intellect. So Carl Jung came up with the unconscious collective, and when you have those psychiatrists that want you to sit on the floor and light incense, those are from Carl Jung. When you have those psychiatrists that are sitting in a chair and want you to look straight ahead and no contact, Sigmund Freud, intellect. So Carl Jung is one of the big thing occult people go on it, and this was his model, and he went through it. And then another guy who went through it in lecture form was what's the white boy who did all the mythology? Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell went through it too. So that's one of that big. It's just a model of explaining the human psyche. You get what I'm saying? And I explained it for us Negroes.
Okay, sound good, brother. Appreciate it too, man.
No problem. No problem, brother.
All right.
All right.
We got caller 321, area code 321. Area code 321, you're on the line. Okay. Brother Panic?
Yo.
All right. Well, okay. I guess we're just going to build that. Come on. All right. Anything else that you want to build on before we get up off of here?
Yeah.
I think we got like about
five more minutes. All right. Well, there's something I do want to get in. There was still more with the Serpent Grail, but I'll add this. The Caduceus staff belongs to the Phoenix or Resurrection or Rebirth, with the orb at the center is the egg of the Phoenix as well as the stone of the Grail legend, otherwise known as the Philosopher's Stone. The orb of astral light is also the Philosopher's Stone is also called the orb of astral light, an astral vehicle. You get what I'm saying? The winged orb, that's why it's winged at the end of the Caduceus, because it's represented as that astral orb. There's something also called the yig, which is represented as an egg or completion with a snake wrapped around it, meaning that Kundalini force is wrapped around this egg. And it's not exploded as in the Big Bang, which the energy is everywhere, and you become humans, matter, and dimensions. All of that is trapped within this yig egg, and that's also represented as the top of the Caduceus and also the thalamus as well. As regard to the physical body, the orb symbolizes the human head or skull, more specifically the thalamus, whose appearance has been described as egg-like, therefore represented as the cosmic egg or stone in esoteric tradition. So again, that's another one that points to the thalamus and the caduceus. It's a whole Kundalini thing. Now, there's one more thing I want to say, and I know we're about to get out, but this is important. Let me add two things. The cauldron symbolized the underworld, that witch's pot, which is also is the Khaldun, or the head of the underworld. As I pointed out, it's called the head of Hades, which is also the Grail. The underworld is the magical realm to which many cultures believe we go when we die. This is also the astral world and the dream world, as the underworld that you're supposed to pass through. The universal hero or archetype shaman is able to visit this realm, then come back again, bringing information, knowledge, and profound wisdom. So now that's one of the things I always talk about why you're supposed to have that eye, that pineal open, why that herb pack is so important, why you're supposed to become the watcher in that world. And then when every black person will tell you, well, this happened and that happened, because every black person has spiritual experience. The thing I ask them, what information did you bring back from that world? You know what I mean? People always tell me all the time, Pat, it was this white thing with this and that, and it had this and it had this. It was over my bed. What does that mean? I'm like, well, I wasn't over your bed. Why don't you ask the goddamn white thing what the fuck does he mean if you are so vividly there with them? Because the whole idea is not just to have these kundalini or out-of-body experiences, it's to bring information and knowledge and profound wisdom back. That's the pathway to that is through practicing astral traveling that eventually gets you into lucid dreaming. Arthur was the son of Uther Pendragon. Uther Pendragon. The name contains the word pen, which means head. So you got all of these codes that's showing you this is a kundalini thing. Like for us now, it seems easy, but if you were dealing with this and didn't know this information, this would be profound and this would be like Sherlock Holmes clues. But since we already done laid our case, all of these things just realign with the head. But they were rather further clues in this ancient play on words. Uther means wonderful, is also similar to Aether, the father of the pagan god Pan. Now, I explained last week that Pan is the pineal. Egyptian mythology, there was a hill that formed, in a mythology, there's a hill that formed out of the waters of Nun. I know it says Geb and Shu separated and became the earth, but there's also a mythology where there was this hill or mound that formed out of Nun, and the god on that mound was called Pn, which is nothing but Pan. You get what I'm saying? Or pineal, and this also means the all. Now, the Greeks attributed their principal god Zeus as Uther. Zeus was born in Uther, and remember, Uther, Zeus, was also considered to be the father of Arthur, who, like Osiris, Horus, Pan, and Jesus, was deemed to be the son of God. So when you hear these quest missions, they not just Jesus, all of these are sons of God, which is just. So we are the sons of God, which is S-U-N's of God. And as I pointed out earlier, our birth mission here is consciousness and nothing else. Our birth mission here is the quest for the Holy Grail, which represents home. You get what I'm saying? And the quest is within, spine to the head. You're not getting past that. So we are born with this quest. Uther was also known as Uther Ben. And Ben in the Hebrew word means first, original, and even head. It is customary for the Jews to name their favorite son Benjamin. So the name Ben could be associated with the first point of creation, with the head. This name is also related to the ancient Egyptian word Ben-Ben and the Bennu bird, the Egyptian phoenix. Now, you cannot say that without saying Dr. Ben. You get what I'm saying? Him as related to the phoenix, that whole mythology of Dr. Ben, the first, if not the first, one of the absolute first, that to start bringing his people back to Egypt. You get what I'm saying? And this is a whole, represented as a resurrection or the Egyptian phoenix. So this resurrection happened physically with Dr. Ben bringing us, and it started what it started and so on. So symbolically, that, you know, it happens physically, but symbolically, all the mythology is there to support. We are also living out this mythology as we go along. The pyramidion or capstone that was placed at the top of the sacred pillars and pyramids constructions represent that shamanistic world pillar in the world mountain. So I'll stop with my notes there, and we'll just let me give you one more of my notes. just to bring it to another mythology. The title, Pendragon. And remember, Uther Pendragon was Arthur's father. Pen, as we understood, also Pendragon, as we understood, means king of kings, not just by the Britons or the Britons, B-R-I-T-O-N, but by the Chinese Manchu dynasty and the Phoenicians. As Pen means head, Pendragon can also be translated as the head of dragons. In mythology, the dragon is interchangeable with the serpent and the snake. It is also the fish, as in the Mesopotamian fish known as the Dagon. And the name reminds us of the African tribe Dogon, who say their ancestors were visited by large fish beings, as well as the Celtic god Dagda. And also, there's also the Dagon is also a deity in Necronomicon. They're worshipped by the deep ones, and they are fish gods. And this is connected to the Dogon. That I go into detail.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Jesus realized that in the New Testament as he became a fisherman and made
right.
And Andrew and Peter, fishermen of men. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Same,
right.
Yeah.
Right. And yes, I go into the Dagon Dogon thing as a fish god and the deep ones in my book. I did a Necronomicon chapter, so I'm not going to give too much away. So I just want to give a little bit more information and also wanted to point out that, Dr. Ben's role has been that of that phoenix, you know what I mean? And, without him, we may have been slow going to where we got to be. So this mythology is also being played out. You can't get away from these stories, and, this is happening with us. So, as we pointed out through both shows, no matter how you slice it with this Holy Grail, you ain't getting past the fact that it has everything to do with Kundalini energy. You ain't getting past it. There's nothing else to do, and I can't see nothing better to do. It's about Kundalini energy. It's about bringing all that energy to your head, activating that pineal to live in that space. You get what I'm saying? I now live in that space, and I don't see myself as no more special than anybody else here on this planet with melanin, chakras, kundalini, and a soul. So if I say it from this place, and I can say it because I also feel whatever I say and whatever I do can be done by you. I don't feel special that kind of way where I've dropped from a fucking meteor somewhere to show you something that you couldn't figure out. It's a matter of how to figure a lot of shit out, which I see us stomped on, which is easy to get unstomped if you're listening to what teachers are telling you. So if you go by that, turn that energy within, know all this shit and all this mythology is a whole elaborate way of trying to tell you you're going to have to find some place by yourself and start studying yourself. It's really about getting to love yourself for your flaws, too. That's one of the first steps, not trying to put on some shit and talk a certain way to go beyond what you think is your flaws and what you think is regular human living, is to actually celebrate what it is you are, even if what you are is a motherfucking asshole. You get what I'm saying? You need to celebrate your asshole-ivity because once you're able to do that, you're at the beginning of knowing yourself, and then you'll start to find it doesn't matter what the world thinks. It's only about how much you can accomplish within that light that you're starting to manifest. And before, I know you got to close out, before you close out, I'm going to give it to people one more time. Our first lecture is going to be with Dr. Aline Bay, and I'm proud to say that is going to be on the 17th and 18th. That's of March, 17th and 18th. The 17th, libation, drumming, meet and greet. You'll get to meet Brother Lean. You'll get to meet other vendors, and you get to dance your ass off and have a little fun. That will be $25. On the 18th will be the actual lecture where you will sit down with your pen and pad. Dr. Aline will teach, and that will be $30. We are selling these tickets in advance because this place, though it's big, it does get packed. It sold out in 3 days. For the last lecture, which was with Dr. Griff, it's Professor Griff and Brother Umar Johnson. Very quick. So we want to make sure anybody listening to the Brother Lean show has first pick if they are in the Atlanta area or North Carolina, South Carolina, wherever it is. Email atlantalectures@hotmail.com. Email for information, how to make payment through PayPal, and in the future we may be set up for some streaming. So I'm not taking emails for the streaming yet, but if you're too far, we're going to be streaming. So you need to do this now. You need to get on now, atlantalectures.com. And again, your very own brother, Aline Bay, Brother Panic will be in the house, a few other special guests, you know, so it'll be a jamboree, and you learn something. So I'll let Aline sign off, but it was fun to be here. We have to do it again soon, I say.
Oh, no doubt about it, I say. And definitely have to do it again. You know, I might have to do like on a remix, you know, Sister Mrs. Blue, and bring you on as co-host or something.
Oh man, I never co-host with. I'm always the guest. I wouldn't even know what that the board is like. I don't know what the board is. None of
right,
that.
Right,
but I mean, we'll keep
what's
it.
What's the co-host?
Yeah, like we'll keep it popping. You know, we figure out how it's supposed to go down,
right,
and
right,
you know
right.
what's supposed to be will be.
Right,
but you
right.
know, I definitely had fun doing these two Wednesdays, and you know, I think we kind of did this subject well. You know, my
right.
Opinion.
Oh, no doubt about it. I mean, the people are loving it. I mean, I'm seeing everybody respond in the chat room. They loving it there. And I'm sure by the time I get on Facebook in about the next 10-15 minutes, I'm pretty sure we're going to have some comments there.
Right.
So, you know, they love you, and you know, I love you. You know what I'm saying? We've been knowing each other since 2004, and, you know, and I got a chance to, get up with Panic, and matter of fact, I went back to listen to your old school hip hop.
The
Baz. I've been watching that all day, and might have to redo one of them. On the show.
Right.
Because,
okay. Yeah,
you
can do that.
You know, you was dropping.
Yeah, we can do some hip hop stuff. We can do some.
Oh yeah.
Hip-hop
oh yeah.
Stuff.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. I'm definitely with that. That sounds like a plan.
First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
Right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance.
Order.
System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.